Good evening. I'd like to call the November 7, 2016 school committee meeting to order.
I got a motion.
Yep.
Move to enter into executive session to discuss strategy with respect to non-represented personnel and return at 7 p.m.
Is there a second?
Oh, second.
Thank you.
Sorry.
It's a roll call vote. Mr. Nian?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
Yes.
Back at 7. Thank you, guys. Good evening. I would like to call the November 7, 2016 school committee back to order from executive session. We have a busy agenda tonight. We're going to start with public comment, as we always do. We have a quick consent agenda. We will do reports. There's one item on the agenda that's relative to a school committee vacancy that I'm going to bump up because I want to discuss it at the outset. We will be getting an update on literacy curriculum. We will be discussing ballot question number 2. Dr. Doherty will be presenting to us district and superintendent goals for the year. And we're going to do something different, which is a quarterly personnel report, something we can chat about when we get there. And then finally, we'll be talking about the beginning of the FY18 budget process from the school committee perspective. So a busy night tonight. I'll start with public comment. Is there anybody in the room who would like to address the committee about an item that is not on the agenda? Seeing none, we'll move on to the consent agenda.
Move to approve the, actually, does anybody have anything they'd like taken off the consent agenda?
Good.
Nope.
Move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second.
All those in favor? It's 5-0. That motion passes. Report. Let's start with our students. Hi, Alex and Mario.
Hi.
What's going on at RMHS?
So this weekend, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, and also next weekend, the Drama Club is putting on The Wedding Singer. They've been working really hard, and they would really like as many people to go as possible. Also, boys soccer and girls soccer both made it to the state tournament, and they sadly were both knocked out of it. The boys soccer went into a shootout after double overtime, and the girls soccer was in double overtime and lost in the last 2 minutes of the second overtime. So they played really, really well.
Thank you.
Well, the football team recently beat Chelmsford, and I think they play Charlestown this weekend. And if they win that, I think they go to the Super Bowl. So hopefully they win.
Lincoln Sudbury.
Lincoln Sudbury? Oh, someone told me Charlestown.
Thank you so much. From the committee, any reports from school committee members? Yeah, Dr. Doxman.
I had the honor of working with the superintendent and with two principals, Joanne King and Sarah Marchand, on a presentation at the Mass Association of School Committees and Superintendents Conference this past week. And it was a wonderful experience on multiple planes. One, it was great to learn more about and refresh about the social emotional learning and the MTSS framework that we use. And two, and along with that, to see all that's involved that our teachers are rising to make this framework really effective, and the data that's been collected that is reinforcing the benefits of using this framework and all that goes with that. And the second thing that was great about participating was working with this group of people, because I really hadn't had the chance. It's very different when you're working sort of one with three individuals as opposed to working at this table with sort of en masse, or it was, so I learned a ton. I learned a ton about what the principals and the teachers grapple with on a daily basis, and that they never shut off, because even driving, there was working going on. I used the phrase here in my description, Energizer Bunnies. But so it was very interesting to be a part of that presentation, both because of the content and because of the working relationship that produced the presentation. Thank you. And it was very well received, lots of good questions. And even though it was at an iffy time, we had a good-sized audience there with good questions.
Anything else from the committee? Dr. Doxer, thank you for representing us there. Appreciate it.
I wish I could have stayed longer.
Oh, yeah. This is Ben.
I just want to say that I really appreciate Linda doing that. And previously, when I was not also working full-time and on the committee, I really enjoyed attending the conference and representing the committee. And so I really appreciate that she makes that a priority. I also want to say RACASA met, so I was looking back at my calendar to see what had happened since the last meeting. So there was a board meeting of RACASA, and you know, I know there was, sometimes it's a little tricky, but there was some letters published to the papers that many of the members were able to sign. So I hope that the community had an opportunity to read those letters in any one of four of the press outlets that they went to. I think it's, you know, RACASA, there are so many issues that we deal with and we talk about with respect to the opioid issue and substance use and misuse. And I know that Erica did put together a fabulous presentation that was at the annual meeting that I think also, I'm not sure if Dr. Daugherty or if it's being used in other places in the school, but it really highlights some of the key issues with our youth related to the YRBS survey. And, you know, linkages between, you know, how certain behaviors, whether it's in regard to tobacco or alcohol or marijuana or other substances, are related to usage in those other areas. So the board's obviously very concerned and continues to look for the opportunities that we can to educate parents, be proactive. John, do you know the date, the video, the film is
November
the
30th?
30th. Here at the Performing Arts
yes.
Center, which is Breaking Points. And that was film screening was at the annual meeting a month ago, but I would highly recommend it to people if you haven't had an opportunity to see that. And then the other quick thing, which maybe we will talk about more in relationship to the budget discussion, is that several of us, all of us were at the financial forum on.
I was not.
Oh, okay, sorry. Chuck, Linda, and I were all also at the financial forum on the 2nd. And the financial forum is organized by the financial committee in town. The board of selectmen and the school committee are invited. If the boards are there, they're in session. And you also have all of the town department heads and school staff department heads. John and his team right here were there. And that was our first opportunity to hear from the town manager and the finance committee in regard to the FY18 budget. And I frankly, there were people in the room. There were not enough people in the room. So I really think this is going to be as hard a year in 11th year on the school committee. This is going to be as hard a year as I ever experienced with respect to the budget. So I hope that as we continue to have financial forums, that our community embraces them and becomes part of that process. So,
I neglected to say that I was also able to attend the youth mental health first aid training class on Saturday, and I highly recommend it for anyone and everyone, and kudos to our staff. There are 605 people that have been trained in this youth mental health first aid now, and they are all with our kids. And I just spent the day feeling very grateful that our teachers, our staff, have gone through that training, and it aligns with, it's all part of the MTSS and being aware of the social-emotional needs of our students and catching things before they escalate. And so, and knowing where to refer, how to get help when it's needed. And so I just wanted to do a shout out to Erica McNamara and RACASA and the Transformation Grant for having made that available to 605 of the staff here and some others from other I almost said countries, we had someone from Nigeria there on Saturday, bringing it back to her support system for girls in Nigeria. It's just very worthwhile and powerful program. Thank you.
Just a point of clarification.
And it's free.
Do we have 600 staff members? I thought the number was in the 500s.
Well, it's staff and others.
Oh, I thought you said 600 staff.
There's a total of over 600 that have been trained. And that includes coaches, it includes,
oh, okay,
includes
so not,
other.
I'm thinking the number's in the budget book.
And
okay,
community members.
No, it's okay, just ask. That's what I thought. Okay, thank
Oops.
You. Okay, anything else from the committee? Dr. Doherty.
I'm actually going to have, first, Mrs. Stout is going to present the budget calendar.
As these are put this way. Let's see if I can get these on my calendar at the
mm-hmm.
right time.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. As we had mentioned at the last school committee meeting, we have pulled together a budget calendar that will be used as a guide throughout the budget process. The calendar that I've just handed out reflects the key dates throughout the process, with obviously the end goal being the school committee presentations at the beginning of January, followed by finance committee and then the town meeting. We've outlined the key steps, which include the meetings we'll be having with the various building principals and department heads, pulling together the various projections. So this is a high-level calendar, which is very consistent with what has been presented in prior years. So just to give everyone a sense of the overall timing, and if there are any questions, we're happy to answer them.
Are you ready to embark on your first budget cycle?
I don't know if it's right to say, I'm actually looking forward to it. I am very excited to be embarking on it. I know it's going to be challenging and difficult, but I am looking forward to it.
Well, we're glad you're here to do it. Any questions on this? Did you have anything else, Ms. Dowd?
Nope, that is all I have.
Did you
have? I do have a brief update. I just want to talk about a couple items. First, professional development. Last Thursday and Friday, November 3rd and 4th, we hosted a training on a program called Just Words. It's a program through Wilson Reading. It's a tier 2 intervention. It's not the tier 3, the real specialized reading. But we had an opportunity to send 2 teachers from Reading Memorial High School, a team chair from Reading Memorial High School, 4 middle school special ed teachers and 2 elementary special ed teachers, along with one of our reading specialists. The program is designed for students who are in grades 4 and above, and can be done in small groups. So the staff seemed very excited about the training opportunity. We also had special educators from Winthrop and Winchester who also participated here. It was at Parker. Last week we also continued with our landmark consultation. And our consultant from the Landmark Outreach Program spent Wednesday afternoon doing a coaching session with some of the staff from Parker, Joshua Eaton, and here at the high school. And I sat in on the session for about 45 minutes, and it was amazing dialogue about students with specific learning disabilities and sharing effective practices and how they were going to support those learners in their buildings. So that was very exciting. In regards to some consultation, I just wanted to update the committee that SEEM Collaborative is having some challenges with hiring BCBAs, and they're usually our first go-to when we're contracting for BCBA services that wouldn't fall under Lisa Studer, our own BCBA. So we are actually seeking out other vendors, and it is a little bit more of a cost that we'll be incurring because we get a discount from SEEM on that. And then for the CPAC, we had over 80 people attend our presentation on anxiety, which was fantastic. Meetings that are coming up, November 30th will be a presentation at the Reading Public Library on ADHD and dyslexia. December 8th will be a presentation on an IEP for my child, and that will be here in the superintendent's conference room. And on December 13th will be the basic rights workshop. And then finally, I'm just gonna hand this out. I just wanted to give you an update on one of the areas in the Walker report. I think it's really timely. It's about transition planning.
One of the concerns that was outlined was, as we transition students from building to building, so from RISE to elementary, elementary to middle, and middle to high school, we needed to have a more comprehensive process. So that process actually starts in November. We have some transition planning forms that our staff will be filling out and submitting by the end of this week, and we'll begin doing our planning and the transition process. The feedback we received from parents last year is they felt it was a much smoother process. We still had a few kinks to work out. Some of the challenges we had was from RISE to elementary, because the PTOs planned some social events for incoming kindergartners, we just realized we needed to know those dates ahead of time so we could make sure decisions are made for those students who are in RISE going to kindergarten. But we have held some special informational sessions at the elementary level, at the middle level, and at the high school level for parents of students who are on IEPs to really help inform them of the process. So I just wanted to share with you this document and the steps we've taken. I just reviewed this again with the team chairs, and I've also sent a communication out to the whole special ed staff about the timelines and the things we need to be doing.
Thank you.
Can I ask a follow-up question on the BCBA?
Yes.
So I understand we're not finding one through SEEM, and there might be a higher cost. Are you confident we'll be able to find someone? We do have someone that we have found who will provide the service, so that is a good thing.
Yeah.
Concerned about the cost, but and we really have to limit Lisa Studer's role because I can't have her doing all the things that people would like her to do, or she wouldn't be able to manage that. So she really works with our Compass, Connections, and Crossroads programs, so Wood End, Birch Meadow, Coolidge, and the high school. And that's really where I've limited her time. The other piece is tomorrow, Lisa is going to be doing a training for our school psychologists on conducting FBAs, so we're trying to build the capacity of some of our own staff, so she can consult with our school psychologists and help support them, so we may not need to contract out for that.
Anything else?
Mr. Martin is going to go next.
Real quickly, I thought I would just say that obviously in addition to Election Day tomorrow, it's our fall in-service day for the district. So I'll give a more complete update next time. But I thought I'd mention that at all levels, all content areas, we have a lot of different trainings and collaborations going on. But I thought tonight I would mention one new thing for this year, which is we actually have a large number of educators in the district participating in some NPEN sessions, which stands for the Northeast Professional Educators Network. A couple of years ago, some districts started collaborating. They determined that if we could sort of get our in-service days in the fall on the same day, and they chose Election Day because many districts already were doing that, that it would be an opportunity for districts to collaborate to provide more high-quality PD to their educators, especially for specialists and lower incident educators. Obviously, it's a real challenge for all districts to be able to provide good professional development for all the different types of positions and all the different types of levels. And so we joined that collaboration. I think last year they had over 500 educators participate, and what I'm hearing so far, it's well over 1,000. I think it's over a dozen districts. So we have a pretty large number attending also tomorrow sessions in Wilmington, Tewksbury, and Chelmsford, and Winchester, and North Reading, and so forth. So we're looking for that to expand and to grow, and hopefully next year we'll be even more a part of it and host some things here. So I can tell you more about that next time.
I have several items. I was going to go a little bit more detail about the financial forum and
that
some of the decisions that were made.
That'd be great.
Around the FY18 budget. So there was some excellent discussion about the financial picture of the town currently and projections going forward, both from a revenue and an expense perspective. So the decisions that the finance committee made, and we also have the moving part this year of the litigation, which plays into this. So a couple of decisions they made, which were very similar to last year when it came to the budget, which allows us budget certainty as we go into the development of the superintendent's recommended budget, which will present to you in January is that they're assuming, they're making assumptions of health insurance being at a 7.5% increase and state aid being a 2.5% increase. If for some reason health insurance is higher than that, or if state aid is coming in lower, then the additional funds would come out of free cash instead of us going back and changing our operating budget proposal. So I think that's been the practice for the last couple of years by the Finance Committee, and it has really helped the town manager and I to not have to wait until health insurance rates come out in February and state aid numbers coming out in April. Mm-hmm. Which, you know, early on when we were developing budgets and during my tenure, that we were always had to wait for those areas. The other shift that they made is they made a decision for this year to shift 0.25% of the capital plan expenditures to the operating budget, which is adds $250,000 to the FY18 budget instead of on capital projects. So as you know, usually it's 5% of the operating budget goes to capital projects. So this year it's going to be 4.75% instead of 5%. In terms of the litigation, up to $2.2 million out of free cash will be used for the $6 million of the litigation. So you have the $800,000 that is currently in the account, the project account, the $2.2 million, which will come out of the cash reserves, and then the remaining $3 million will be paid for through debt, so that they will borrow most likely over 10 years the $3 million. The reason why the larger number for cash reserves is obviously that means that you have less that you have to borrow, and also which means then more can be done for capital projects long term. And then the last piece of the puzzle that was voted on was how much would be put into the operating budget from cash reserves. Over the last few years, it has been around $2 million. In fact, it was 2.1, I believe, a year ago. So the Finance Committee, after a lot of deliberation, voted to add $1.2 million of free cash for FY18. So what that means, it's a little bit brighter picture than originally. We were looking at a $300,000 to $400,000 increase when we were having the talks this summer. It's now up to about a $700,000 increase. Not at the $2 million structural deficit that we were, we were hoping, but it's a little bit better than it was.
Can I ask a follow-up question, just because there's been a little bit of confusion in the community about the debt for the litigation? So $3 million is being proposed for debt. That's inside the tax levy. So that
yes.
is not something that goes to voters. That's not a debt exclusion.
Correct.
That is just something that we can handle internally. I just wanted to make that clear.
That is correct.
There so are
what
people
will happen
who are under
is,
the impression that this will go to ballot.
The capital projects, so for example, if we were going to have a roof done at a school in FY20, and now it may get pushed to FY22. So what's going to happen is capital projects are going to get delayed. They're going to be moved forward to a couple, 2 to 4 fiscal years, depending on what the project is. Any questions on that piece? Okay. A couple other things which I communicated out this week. First of all, we are looking for budget parents. So I did send something out to the community this weekend. Ideally, we would like 2 budget parents for each school and also 2 budget parents from the CPAC. So that'll be, we're starting to get emails in to Linda if the community's interested. We'll probably start meeting late November, early December, and start talking about the FY18 budget process with the budget parents. And the commitment really is some meetings in December, most of the meetings in January, and a couple of meetings in February and March, both before school committee meetings and during school committee meetings. So if you are interested, just contact our office and let us know. In addition, this week, I also communicated to the community that I'm going to begin holding office hours. So this week, and I do plan on rotating them at the beginning of each week, I'll communicate the date, location, time. So this week, it's going to be from 8 o'clock to 9 o'clock this Thursday, where this is kind of a weird week. We're doing Thursday from 8 to 9. And also, we're going to do Saturday from 9 to 10. And both of those will be here. Really, it gives the community an opportunity to come in and talk about different issues that may be affecting the district. So I don't know if we'll have a good turnout or I'll have a good turnout, but I want to make sure people have that opportunity to be able to share any concerns or views that they have. So that's going to begin this week, and at the beginning of each week, I will communicate it out. I'd like to have them at different schools, usually around drop-off or pickup time, if parents, you know, so it gives parents the opportunity. I had the opportunity on Saturday to go to the second annual Science Expo at Coolidge Middle School. I believe there was 28 projects from elementary and middle school students that were presented. Basically, it was an open-ended topic. Students could pursue a variety of interests and I saw life, physical, and earth science topics. I saw an experiment on lava lamps, soda density, the five-second rule in bacteria. Kids did a great job. I had an opportunity to talk to a lot of them. You could tell that they were getting no grade on this. There was no other motivation other than the love of science and engineering and just to be able to do this. So and our Reading Robotics team was there also with demonstrations. They also had some hands-on experiments going on in the cafeteria. So it was, overall, it was a great opportunity for kids. And I want to thank Eileen Manning and Marianne Downing for coordinating this for the second year in a row.
Yeah.
And let's see. Two other items. This Wednesday is going to be our annual kindergarten orientation meeting for the class of 2030, I believe. It is kind of scary, but and that'll be at Killam beginning at 7 o'clock. Usually at that meeting, we give an overview of the different kindergarten programs, the curriculum, and some of the logistics around registration and things like that. So that's going to be this Wednesday at 7 o'clock at Killam. And then the last piece I just want to share with the committee that and I don't know, Mrs. Borowski, if you want to talk about the town meeting prep that we just had. So
I'll let you take it.
Yeah, all right. So town meeting begins on Monday night. And as you know, we have a special town meeting that will be occurring during the regular town meeting to discuss the RMHS litigation. We do not know yet if the RMH litigation special town meeting will be the first night. We're still waiting to see if we'll have a final agreement. If we have a final agreement, then we will have special town meeting on Monday night. If not, we will start with the regular town meeting. If we do have the special town meeting on Monday night, I will not be doing the state of the schools on Monday night. I'll be doing it on Thursday night. So we will not be doing both items on the same night. There is also going to be another special town meeting, which is not school related, that is scheduled right now for the 21st. And there are several articles, and as you know, in this year's town meeting. So that is my report.
Thank you. Thank you for doing the office hours. I think it's a great idea. And to your point about budget parents, it's a wonderful way. There's been a lot of more probably engagement in the parent community this year than maybe in past years about the budget, and this is a phenomenal way for parents to be involved and understand the school budget. So I would really encourage parents who are interested in emailing the superintendent's office to apply for those positions, those volunteer positions. Okay, thank you, Dr. Dorr.
Thank you.
Mr. Martin.
Do you want to go right to the update?
Literacy curriculum update,
excellent.
I think, is next on the list.
I'm going to kick it off, but I want to let our literacy coach, Patricia Stott, get set up here. We have several of our curriculum leaders. Support. So I'll kind of start things off while they get set up. So our goal tonight was to give you a sort of an overview or an update on what's happening in literacy, and we thought we would focus primarily on the foundational grades, elementary, then sort of what we're also moving into middle school. So we have a couple of our curriculum leaders and teachers from elementary school, as well as a couple of our teachers from middle school, a couple of our administrators who are the ELA liaisons in our curriculum structure, Mrs. King and Mr. McSweeney. But it's very exciting to think, I was actually talking to one of the teachers earlier this evening about what kids, to think about what kids will be better able to do when they're moving up into high school. You can click over the next slide. I thought I would start off with this quotation. You know, what we're finding is when we really provide students these high expectations and the opportunities to actually do this work, the doing of it every day, it's amazing. Ms. Dodd and I often have talked about sort of a metaphor of what happens in other art forms like music. You know, that when we visit the band class or something, kids aren't necessarily just doing activities about the trumpet or about music. They're actually playing. You know, they're playing the instrument. They might have lessons about the technique or the things, but then they're actually doing it. And you've heard me talk about that before. That's sort of a theme across all of the standards that have been revised in the state over the last several years. If you go to the next slide there, I think I've showed you this overlap before. So whether we're talking about the ELA standards, which is the bottom yellow here in this sort of Venn diagram, or the math or science, I kind of call them the standards of doing. And it's across all content areas, and they overlap. And it really is not just learning about things, but it's doing. It's actually becoming writers, readers, scientists, mathematicians, to give kids those authentic experiences, which not only engages them and creates their own excitement, but I think they start to see that I can truly do this, and they start picking out the path they want to go on in the future. So with that, I want to hand it over to Tricia to kind of walk us through.
Know this because we live this. The amount of information that our kids are having in their world right now is a huge amount. So much so that I just wanted to kind of bring this point forward. That there's a lot of information. It's not like I think when I was in school, we had to learn certain finite set of information, and now it's not about that. It's about like what can you do with the information that's out there. And so this is right from the MASS frameworks, the literate person of the 21st century, and how they define it. And so I just highlighted the key points that really are driving us with the shifts that we're making in literacy and writing. And really the language, the speaking, the listening, the writing, reading, it's all happening at the same time. We're teaching kids to read very critically and closely, and pay attention to vocabulary, to love reading and want to read, and also reading and finding evidence in their reading to support their thinking. There's a lot of, seeing how beneficial it is to allow kids to talk about what they're reading and have conversations and debate around that. And so part of the district improvement plan is just this, to focus in on literacy, among many other things, but that's what I'm here to talk about today. And so literacy instruction has always pretty much had these three big categories: foundational skills, reading comprehension, and writing. And I think the shift here is that the reading comprehension and the writing, the demands are much greater than they were. We, our foundational skills, we pretty much are doing a really good job of that, teaching kids how to decode, how to be accurate when they're reading their words, and being fluent. But the comprehension and the writing skills have definitely increased in demand.
And so we're teaching things like making inferences, synthesizing information, talking about how writers write books and why they put certain things in the books, talking about author's craft, and back to that whole idea of supporting their thinking with evidence. And I put this big statement at the bottom about building agency and independence, because that is something that we're seeing is really an important part of getting kids to reach these high levels, is having them want to pick up a book on their own, wanting to sit down and read for big chunks of time, or write for big chunks of time, and be engaged while they're doing that. And so, back to this slide, just for a second, recognize this, that if you don't teach these skills early on in the years of elementary school, we're not going to meet those high demands. So I had to throw in these two examples of kindergarten writing. And here's a prime example of a real audience. The kid has an audience, and he's writing about something that's really important to him. He actually brought this to the speech and language pathologist to show that he really, things were sticking with him. He really was learning. And here is just another example of a kindergartner writing about how to do a rock run. So even in kindergarten, they're writing all three types of genre. They're writing opinion pieces, what kinds of things they like, how to do things for their informational writing, and then starting the year off with the narrative pieces. So some instructional goals that we're really focusing on this year is increasing knowledge of grade level expectations for reading and writing. How does reading develop across the years from K to six and beyond? And knowing that so that we can best help our students move along that progression. Another goal that I feel like is really important, I'll talk more about this, is valuing writing process over product. That we'll talk about the whole writing process, and that it's a messy process, and it's less emphasis on the finished product, but more about the steps that the writer takes as they're trying to produce them. Delivering effective mini lessons that are focused, short. I almost think of them like laser sharp. They're really strategic in what they're teaching, short, so that the students maybe will be listening to a mini lesson for about 10 minutes, but the majority of the workshop period of time is actual kids practicing. Another goal that I added here was modeling and demonstrating reading strategies, high level reading strategies that we're talking about that meet those demands in a read aloud situation where the teacher would be modeling the thinking so that kids could then turn around and try that on their own. And I already mentioned the agency and independence, but it's an important goal to have kids want to pick up a book. I think that's that love of reading, that lifelong love of reading, or seeking out information on their own is an important goal to set for kids. And so we're looking at finding ways or practices in our classrooms to find or to set up real reasons for kids to write, to advocate for themselves with essays, writing ways that they want to improve their world that really makes sense to them, deepen their own knowledge and share it with others when they're doing their informational writing, their how-to books or their all-about book about sharks. And then even in the reading and the writing, really broadening their scope of what the world is about while they maybe investigate characters and understand characters, just like they would understand people, learning life lessons in a book that they're reading, they can transfer that over to their own lives. So some of this is a huge list, I'm not gonna go through all of it, but just really creating a classroom of writers or readers that really have some major, I guess, important characteristics. One of them is writing every day and reading every day for a good amount of time. The principals got together, I think, last summer and sort of figured out a way to carve out some time for writing to happen every day, at least close to every day, so that kids get that predictable time that they know they're going to be able to write at a certain time each day. And that, I think, that builds stamina for kids. Kids being able to write down the page in fifth grade, three quarters of a page in about 5 or 10 minutes, that's something that kids need sort of to build up those muscles. Another characteristic I wanted to highlight is storytelling. That's a shift that we've made in the kindergarten classroom, sort of making the beginning months of kindergarten a little bit more developmentally appropriate, not jumping right into writing on the page, but actually learning how to tell a story orally and building up the oral language. So that builds a foundation for all the rest of the grades. I think I'm going to move on to the next slide. And so that brings me to the principles of writing workshop. And this is really based on all of the things that I've said up to this point. The philosophy of writing workshop is really to provide these key elements, having kids work towards independence. This is not where teachers give an assignment and kids do the assignment. This is where kids are learning how to be writers. You'll walk into classrooms, you'll see teachers saying, you know, writers, come over here and meet me on the rug. We've got writing to do. Giving kids choice within each genre. We teach three genres, but giving kids choice within those genres so that the writing is meaningful. It's not something that the teacher has decided, but the kid has some sort of investment in it. I already talked about time, strategic teaching with the mini lessons, process over product. And the last one is writing identity, and just having the kids see themselves as readers and writers is a big goal. And that's something that I think happens in writing workshop. So the writing process that we follow within the writing workshop is the same as any author follows. It looks sort of like a perfect circle, but it's much messier than that. When you start writing, we all know, you know, there's a lot of rehearsing going on, thinking about it in your head, drafting it out, revising, maybe drafting again. So the kids learn this messy process. I used to tell the kids, the messier the better, you know, adding on, moving around. It does not have to be perfect. So this is a nice example of where we celebrate. This is a picture from a classroom where they're celebrating the process. These are not perfect pieces of writing. You can see crossouts and revision, and that's exactly what this is a revision wall. The title is How Can I Revise My Writing? The kids actually made up that. So it's a nice review of the lessons, strategies that they were learning. Adding dialogue, using sensory details, and they actually highlighted in their writing how they made it better. The workshop time is broken up into three sections. I don't know what happened to my labels, but maybe if I click.
If you keep clicking,
yeah. There we go. The mini lesson is how the workshop starts, and that I've already kind of touched upon that, where that's as close to 10 minutes as you can possibly get it, but it's tough. It's tough for us teachers to get that down to 10 minutes. That's why it's a goal that we're setting for ourselves. But to have that be a time almost like a promise to kids that we're going to talk for a short time, I'm going to give you a strategy, it might be helpful today in your writing. And then the majority of the time is independent writing time, and that's that practice time where kids get to try things out and practice. It also allows the teacher to do individualized teaching. So that's where the teacher can conference with kids one-on-one, or the teacher can pull a bunch of kids together in a small group if they all sort of need similar things. And then we always wrap up the workshop with a share, teacher share. It's not where every kid shares their writing. That would take forever. But it's a strategic choice that the teacher makes. Maybe in the independent writing time, she sees a couple of kids who could lift the writing of the rest of the class, and she highlights that. Or she might see that the class is struggling with something, and she might do some reteaching at that point. This is just a great example of two kids that, at a celebration, sort of stopped everything and said, well, we need to revise, we want to add on, and they actually went and got scissors and revision strips and started working together. This is a fifth grade and a third grader. It just highlights that sometimes I would bring the fifth graders into the younger grades and they'd be able to help each other, and they could almost help each other more than I could help each other because they had similar language and they could talk it out with each other, and it would be a great way for them to strengthen, the fifth graders, to strengthen their skills while the third graders benefited. So this writing workshop, we're starting to implement the units of study, and it really does have a depth that goes across from K to 8. We're using the units of study K to 6 currently, and I just wanted to show you that it really does connect and build upon each other. So there really are some foundation blocks here in K1-2. K, just trying to get that message down onto the paper, trying to get the sounds and the letters matched onto the paper is a big feat, and it's always amazing to see what kind of growth they make in kindergarten. And then moving on to starting to think about, well, how do I get a story on paper, a beginning, a middle, and end, and then moving into a zoomed in moment, like not the whole trip to Disneyland, but maybe just one of the rides. And then by fifth grade, you start talking about significance, trying to get the kids to realize that we write for reasons, and trying to get them to fit in a life lesson, like something that they realize because of this experience. All the way up to eighth grade, where they start thinking about that message turns into a social message. So I just wanted to emphasize the idea of that strategic mini lesson. And so these are just some examples of some anchor charts that kind of are the remnants of that strategic teaching. Can your pictures teach more? So the mini lesson was most likely like ways your pictures can teach. And so this chart was probably used as the mini lesson. This is from one of our first grade classrooms. And then it's in the room as a support for kids when they need it. And so you can see writer partner charts and charts to help you remember how to stretch out sounds. So these are all supports for kids as we move through the unit of study. This is a good example of how that strategic teaching really does lift the level. So here's a mini lesson on writing an introduction for an informational book. What is a lizard? You can see the teacher demonstrated how to do that introduction. She showed a mentor text. What am I is sort of like a guess who kind of mentor text introduction. And then you see the little first grader who was writing about geckos decide that he's going to change his introduction. And I'll read it to you because you can't see it. But I like to swim. I can change color. And I have scaly skin. I am a gecko. And so it's very much similar to this, but not exactly. So he's kind of practicing and trying out some of this author's craft out for himself. And so I already spoke about independent practice, but I can't say it enough that this is really where the learning happens. One of the quotes that I heard that stuck with me when I was at Teachers College at Columbia was, students are being overtaught and underpracticed. And so it's sort of like, we want to help so much as teachers, that's just our instinct. And we don't want them to suffer or be frustrated, and so we want to jump in. It's hard for us not to jump in. But I think this allows us to sort of give a mini lesson to the whole class, and then give time to the kids to practice, and then we can tailor the instruction to the individual kids. That's what this is. And so one of the things that you'll see in our classrooms are kids using checklists with the expectations for their grade level, teachers using those checklists, just really being clear about what our expectations are for narrative writing, for informational writing, or opinion writing. This is an example that I'm actually going to use tomorrow with the teachers. We're going to be scoring collaboratively our narrative, our pre-assessment narrative pieces. And this is just an example of a blown up checklist from grade to grade, so K1-2. And this is craft, so what are the moves that the author has used to sort of make it more interesting, bring out the story so that you want to read it. And so it starts in kindergarten with just adding like speech bubbles or details, and maybe in the pictures. And then moving on to second grade, where you're using strong words like raced instead of walked or went. And then third grade, trying to make a movie in the reader's mind, all the way to fifth grade, where they're starting to add figurative language and symbolism. So you can see the progression. And the kids are using these checklists to sort of figure out where they are. Am I here? Does my writing look like this? Or does it look like this? And having exemplars in the classroom for the kids to sort of say, okay, what am I trying out? What's the next logical step? This is another example of just that. Like, where does, this is an example from reading, where the kids are reflecting on their reading. This is sort of the beginning stages of responding to reading. And so you can see, this is an example of post-it notes in varying levels of difficulty. So Rob is caring, which is very simple, all the way up to Rob is caring because and giving a quote from the text. So you can see how the teacher has outlined sort of the stages, and kids will fall into certain categories and they can sort of see, okay, what do I need to do to get to the next level? The one thing that I really like about this philosophy is that we try to see what kids are trying out, what kids are approximating, and that's where we want to zoom in and say, okay, they're trying this out. It's not quite right yet. It's not quite at the level we want it. So that's where I'm going to focus in and kind of nudge them to the next level. I must have been talking really fast. All right. So what I wanted to share with this slide is that we've done a lot of work in the last year. This is my second year in this position, and I think we're just getting started. But we've I think looking back to put this slide together, we have accomplished some things here. Whole group professional development. We trained 120 teachers in the fall between North Andover and Reading Public Schools across about, I think, 8 days of professional development. We keep working with our district PLCs to bring teachers together to talk about their teaching craft. We've had some study groups. We had a great study group last spring with the kindergarten through second grade teachers who studied this book called Talking, Drawing, Writing. And we teamed up with Plymouth Public Schools. They came to visit us, and they taught a lesson for us. We had a great discussion, follow-up discussion. And then we were able to buy that book for all kindergarten teachers. So that's where that push of storytelling came from, really from a discussion with teachers last spring. And then this year we started a collaborative proposal time where teachers can sort of choose what they want to study. And so we have a couple of book clubs happening. And I also started two groups, a K-2 group and a 3-5 group, to sort of be a buddy group where teachers could team up and kind of help themselves, help each other collaborate as they go through these units of study and learn how to sort of like hone their craft. We're trying to establish some lab classrooms. So I've been going into classrooms, coaching side by side, learning myself with teachers. It's been really nice to be able to reflect with teachers and grow and see how we can better educate our kids. Quality feedback, reflection, and dialogue is what moves our practice. It moves the kids, and it moves our practice as well. And that brings it to Carrie. Thank you. Carrie's going to talk about, and Tanya, they're going to talk about what it looks like in the elementary classroom, and then Donna and Laura are just going to talk about how it moves on to middle school.
Okay.
Do you want me to click it?
Sure. All right, so I'm going to talk a little bit about what the reading looks like in a fourth grade classroom and why I love it so much. So before kind of using the reading workshop approach, it would always be you would read a story, you would kind of know the child and sort of by retelling. Okay, what happened? What's the setting? Tell us about the big problem. And the shift that I appreciate so much now is that the children are really looking at character development throughout a story. So it's no longer, okay, this is the problem. It's, we know that every story has more than one problem, and we want to really understand how a character is going to react in these problems. And so the kids start to notice that there are patterns with the way characters react, and sometimes these patterns shift, and that's like an aha moment for them. They're like, oh my goodness, I thought Rob was going to react this way, but when this other character came into the picture, now he's reacting in a different way. I didn't expect that. So I use a mentor text with the kids. It's very much aligned with what Tricia was talking about with the writing. So we're reading a book called Tiger Rising. It's a very thought-provoking book. And I'll have a mini lesson based off that book that the kids then will try to apply to a book that's just right for them. So the level of engagement is there. And it's also through the mentor text, I'm teaching the kids, right, this is how you have a book discussion. So we have to remember, reading is invisible, so we can't see it like with writing out a math problem. It has to be done through conversation and discussion. So the greatest thing that I see happening in my classroom is I'm shoulder to shoulder with these kids on the floor, and they're having discussions about the characters and the situations that the characters are in. So just an example I was sharing today was, we're reading a book, Stone Fox, and I don't know if you're familiar with the story, but this little boy is in this dog sled race against this grown man who's a Native American. They both desperately want to win this race. The little boy wants to win it because his grandfather's dying, he needs money to pay taxes or he's going to be homeless. The Native American wants to win it so he can buy back land for his people. And this little girl in my class who, you know, was having some comprehension issues, she said to me, we're conferencing, she goes, you know, Mrs. DiNapoli, at first I thought Willie really needed to win that money because of his grandfather. But now I'm thinking that maybe it's Stone Fox because he's not being selfish, it's not just for him. And then the whole group started to chime in. Well, he won 5 races, and this is Willie's first race, so it was this whole discussion, and he had land taken away from him. And it was this whole discussion about social injustice that I could never have done through a worksheet. It was done, it was brought on by the kids, it was things that they noticed about the character. They noticed that how hard and little Willie's working and how hard this Native American is working. And then the story totally shifts and the Native American lets the little boy win. Because the little boy, it's like a heartbreaking story that these kids are like, these stories are so sad. I'm like, I know, that's what it's all about. Like, you're at such a great age, you're reading these really, really rich stories. So they couldn't believe it. And there was a whole discussion. Oh my gosh, I can't believe he let little Willie win. I would have never done that. So, and you know, it just went on and on. And it was beautiful. This clip is from my classroom. You can play it and then maybe I can talk a little bit.
Of its name to entertain us because it's set in Old Larry. Mrs. Old Larry died 100 years before she took off the blame. So if she died, I wouldn't entertain you if you knew, like, she died before thinking she...
Right, but the part that's entertaining is a count of the minor seriously, but don't you think if the part were, if the author didn't put the part where Mrs. O'Leary died because she got the blame, if the author didn't include that, I think that might have been a part.
I'm not even involved in here, and they're going on, and they're realizing that the author has a purpose. So they were reading a nonfiction text, they were reading about the Chicago Fire, and how a reporter made up a story that this woman's cow started the fire. And so we were talking about how it's important that you really have to have the information, and that text boxes are important. And so they were discussing, you know, how does this happen? You know, how could this cow pick over this lantern and start a fire? So again, it's all student prompted. And it's so interactive. It's just like what you would do if you were going to a book club. You're not going to go there and fill out a worksheet on, yeah, I liked this part. You're going to talk with your friends about what you discovered and what you thought was important or what shocked you. So we train the kids how to do that with sticky notes. They stick it right in a book. You know, this is a part that I was wondering about. So it's very, very student directed. And I love it because I'm shoulder to shoulder with them. I'm in the discussion and I'm learning from them. There are things that I didn't even think about that they bring to my attention because their minds are so innocent and not cluttered with all that information that they can see things crystal clear that as an adult, they're like, oh my gosh, that went right over my head. I can't believe you taught me that. So one of the other things that I just love about teaching reading this way is I used this book. Tanya McGuire and I, we've done a lot of collaborating together. We specialty teach in fourth grade, so I'm the only fourth grade teacher in my building that will teach writing. And so Tanya over at her school, she's at Killam, so Joanne and the Killam principal really valued the collaboration. So Tanya and I would get together and we would create lessons. And we had talked about Fox when I went to New York to a conference. They had used this book and I loved it. So I had read it to the kids. And the greatest thing about this, where the reading and writing are so closely linked, is that when we read books now, we read it like a writer and we pay attention to author's craft. which I think is really important, and it's something that they then try in their writing. So just real quick, because I really want to do this justice, and the words that I have, you have to really come and see it, so I invite you. You may come. Come see fourth graders talk about it. So this book is, we talked about what we know about foxes and stories, and we all know a fox is sly. So this fox is very, very sly. And I read this part to the kids, and I read it, and then I said, you know, guys, I did a think out loud. So I'm just going to read this quickly so you can just kind of hear the language. After the rains, when saplings are springing up everywhere, a fox comes into the bush. Fox, with his haunted eyes and rich red coat, he flickers through the trees like a tongue of fire, and magpie trembles. So this bird is injured, and she sees this fox, and the kids are like, okay, I'm going to read it again and pay attention to the words the author uses to describe the fox. And the kids are like, oh my gosh, this is the first time Fox gets introduced to the story. He's really bad, I can tell. Like, they're describing him like fire. I said, oh, all right. So I'm wondering why every time the author describes the dog, she's using blue skies, light as air, and like, that's because the fox is good. So they're learning about tone and word choice. And so one of the most powerful lessons that I did with them, it was a quick little figurative lesson. So I had pictures like of a tornado, of a heart, of a meadow, an arrow. I said, you know, if you were to describe Fox, how would you describe him? And one of the kids went right up and picked up the tornado. They said, and I taught them like or as a simile. Wow, Fox is like a tornado because he leaves destruction wherever he goes. I said, that is beautiful. That's a simile, that's figurative language. That's exactly right, that's what Fox is like. And then, it's right here. So then when we're doing writing, so we're working on, they get to choose their own story that they want to write about. I read this in writing and I couldn't believe it. It said, it's about a football game. Dive, the coach yelled. Jeff felt like there was a tornado of urge just sitting waiting to erupt in his stomach. Right, that's fourth grade writing, right? Is that beautiful? I mean, that is rich writing that I know as a kid, I was never taught that. I was never taught to do that. And it's because they take the mentor text and they own it, and they really become invested in it. I could talk on and on about this, but I won't bore you. I just get very excited. So this is another example of the writing and the reading, how closely they're related. So we always talk about how the author really uses detail and really describes scenes. So I had the kids, they wrote a little scene, and this little girl said, Eliza yawned, she moved over on top of her bed. And then they had to just pick, I said, pick one small, tiny little scene that you're going to zoom in on. So I said, the tiniest. So she said she moved on top of her bed. And then she zoomed in. This is a little magnifying glass. And then she came up with, Eliza yawned. She moved on top of her bed, sinking in like quicksand, pulling her into the bed. And I said, oh my goodness, I can picture that. That's just like a fox moment. I could make a mind movie in my mind and imagine her just sinking into that soft bed. So I'm just going to leave you with one other quick little enthusiastic teacher share moment here. So another way that we tie in reading and writing is we do short stories for literary essays. And I had read the kids a story called Retired, about this retired school teacher who was feeling really lonely, elderly, and this elderly dog that a family had to give up because they were moving, they couldn't take the dog with her. So they give the dog to this elderly woman. And the story goes on, and the dog kind of gives her kind of a reason. And she goes for walks, and one day she walks by a schoolhouse and there are all these kids, and the dog's excited because she misses her kids. The woman's excited because she was a retired school teacher. And so they develop this friendship with the kids and they go every day. So I thought, oh, this would be really interesting. So I had the kids rewrite the story from the perspective of the dog. So I just want to share a couple just quick little moments with you. This little girl that I had came to me without being able to speak a word of English. And the only way that we could communicate was through stories and picture books and from her drawing. And so by the end of the year, this is what she was able to write. Now pay attention, this is fourth grade, and she is writing using symbolism, which is something that we don't even expect them to write with until really fifth grade, middle school. So she's pretending she's the dog, and the dog's getting given away. My tail fell between my legs. I love this family, and I disagree with the big change that's going to happen. I can't believe it. The old car moved away. The kids, the love, the good days, all of this is gone with my family inside the old car that now is more than a mile away. I know, right? When I tell you, when I read this, I'm talking, this little girl, all she could do was draw pictures. And she cried for the first 6 months of school. I cried for the first 6 months of school. And we would just snuggle in on my rug, and she would draw a picture, and I would label it. And then she would draw another picture. Okay, that's the beginning of the story. This is the middle of the story. Whenever I was reading a mentor text, her parents were kind enough to buy her the text in her language so she could follow along with the story. And so, just one more. Then I'll really, I promise I'll leave you. I'll be like, feel free. Wood End from 205. So when she was talking about when the children came to the, when the dog kept going back with the woman to the schoolhouse, she said here, I felt so glad when their soft and warm hands touched my head and back. This time I knew their names. I could even tell who was whose hand was whose by the way they were petting me. So this is the power of reading and writing workshop. I mean, this is the evidence right here. And I always tell the kids, you always have to have evidence. So I'm going to then now turn it over to Tanya, who will talk more in depth about how the writing is designed and how it supports the reading.
Mm-hmm. And so I'm just going to, Trish did a lot of the overview of it, but what we do is we start off with a mini lesson. And in that mini lesson, we're really strategic. We're teaching one small little piece of the writing. We might use a mentor text, as Carrie mentioned, and we will use interactive charts where the students are engaged in a scaffolded trial of the strategy. And then the main part of the lesson is students go off and work independently, and they're working on their choice activities. So there's a lot of enthusiasm. They can't wait to get back to their desks and start writing. Many days I'll say, two more minutes, friends, and they're going, oh man, come on, can we have 10 more minutes? So they are very engaged in this writing process. During that time, that's when the differentiated instruction happens. Everyone's working independently on their story, and they all have strategies they can use so that they can continue to work independently. And so the teacher then has time to sit right side by side and work with the students and come right down to their level and what their needs are. And it could be also pulling small groups during that time if there's several children working on the same strategy and needing the support. Once that time's over, then as Trish mentioned, there's a share out at the end. And oftentimes in my classroom, I pick one or two students that have done a really good job and have demonstrated the strategy very nicely, and that helps raise the level of the rest of the students in the class. This writing workshop approach has increased the complexity of my students' writing over and over. I taught sixth grade 12 years ago. My fourth graders in November of fourth grade are writing better than my sixth graders at the end of a whole school year. That's the power of this writing workshop and the power of giving students choice and teaching strategies strategically and meeting students at their level. The special education teacher that works in my room, she pushes in. She works with three students. And last Thursday walked into my room and she just walked up to me and said, Tanya, last year I couldn't get these students to write but two or three sentences, and now they're writing pages and pages. And today I asked her, why do you think that is? And she said, because the mini lessons are so strategic that the students walk away from them knowing that they can do it and that they can be successful. And there's this enthusiasm within the classroom that pushes all students to want to try it at their own level. That enthusiasm is really what is quite amazing.
I think the other big piece behind it is they have very clear goals. Like, this is what your goal is for today's lessons. So it's broken down into small pieces.
And it feels doable to them.
It feels doable. I think that one of the things that we need to mention is why this works so well is the collaboration that happens with teachers. And we do a lot of sharing out with our PLC. We have a really excited group of women that We come together and share these ideas, and then they try it out, and we come back, we talk about what worked, what didn't work. I also think it's really important, I've been lucky enough to have Duane as my principal, and really understanding how sacred that reading and writing time is, and making sure that that does happen in my schedule on a daily basis. And then I think having a really knowledgeable coach coming in and working side by side and co-teaching with me has raised my level of teaching, that she can, I mean, there's a lot of resources out there for teachers, but she can point me in the right direction and say, these are high quality, like try these out, and I'll try them out, and we're just like, oh my gosh, that was fantastic. So just learning from each other, I think that's been, it's been the key behind it, so. We can't say enough about it. I hope you can feel our enthusiasm.
Definitely.
Any questions before we?
Oh, at the end, okay, we'll go there, okay.
I just want to start by saying they're doing such a great job that we're seeing it in both the reading and the writing literacy across the curriculum, actually, in the work that the kids are doing in the classroom. You know, we still have our jobs in the morning, but they are doing such a wonderful job. We are just going to really focus, it's more like an overview of what we do as far as reading and writing. It's more of a push for independent reading. I know that Tricia alluded to it before about independence and agency, where we're setting aside time in the classroom that the kids are making their own selections, choosing, you know, their own books, and reading, for because we're trying to make sure that there's an increase in volume, and that we're building stamina. And so we're doing it right, you know, in the classroom. Also, we encourage them to read at home as well. We, again, are taking what the elementary school teachers are doing and sort of just, you know, even through talks that we have with them about encouraging them to become lifelong readers. We give them the statistics of how most successful people were lifelong readers. It just, you know, it kind of plays out in whatever they do in life. At Parker, we've had the grade books for many years now. And when the frameworks changed, the grade books roundtable changed as well, and it became a little bit less of a book filled with short fiction stories and more of an anthology, a two-word anthology to kind of match with the, you know, the curriculum and the state curriculum. So it was, we have short stories by famous authors. We have pieces of nonfiction, and we have poetry in these great books. It's set up in a wonderful way, and what the active reading strategies that they participate in are things that they can carry across any text and across, really, and use those same strategies when they're reading not only just fiction, but nonfiction as well in other content areas. They start out pretty much, it's kind of procedural. They start out with a read aloud from the teacher, and they're annotating the text, the teacher's reading aloud. So oftentimes with the first one, we model that for them. And then they read it silently, and they take directed notes. And then they generate some questions. And oftentimes the teachers use the questions, the interpretive questions that they come up with to start a discussion, which is, I think, really sort of the core of the program, and that is the discussion. It resembles a Socratic seminar. So if you walk in, you can see sixth graders participating. You know, they look as if they're in grad school at times. It's amazing. We serve as facilititators, and we let them know that. Other than dressing up like Socrates, we just explain to them that we're going to sort of sit outside of the circle. We may start them. We may go over some of the rules and regs of how to respectfully disagree with one another. But basically, we're just there as facilitators, and it's student-led. They run their own discussion, you know, and so we didn't videotape, but it's amazing. I just ran my first one last week, and my jaw drops at some of the things that they do, you know, they do come up with, and I feel the conversations are even stronger because of what's going on at the elementary level. After that, there's usually some type of prompt. It could be in the form of an interpretive or an evaluative question, and the kids respond after the discussion. So there's a literary analysis piece attached to this. And so it's just, I can't say enough about great books. I've been teaching great books now for 20 years, and I think it's one of the best things to come down the pike. Anytime I've taken a course or a workshop and people hear, you know, Great Books comes up and you'll hear people saying, oh, I wish we had that in our district. And, you know, I say, well, we've had it. I've never known anything, you know, any difference. And, you know, there's a little sigh of, not maybe jealousy, but a little bit, you know, because we've had it. And it's sort of morphed depending upon the need now with the curriculum. Well, I love the classics, I have to admit. And I'm really happy to say that across the sixth graders, the seventh graders, and the eighth graders, and across, so Coolidge and Parker, are reading the same core texts. In sixth, they're reading The Adventures of Ulysses. In seventh, they're reading A Christmas Carol. And in eighth, Romeo and Juliet. So, you know, so we're getting them ready, Mike, for high school and college. So we're really proud of that. I just wanted to also say that I in my years teaching, when I look at the kids' work coming in, I see such a difference, a major difference. Can I tell, or do you, I'll let you tell about the text that you brought tonight. Okay. But I said to Laura, I have to share this. I mean, I've been teaching adolescents, as I said, for a long time, and I've had some, as we used to call them, struggling readers and reluctant readers. And I haven't heard that phrase in a while now. And actually, I had a timer on because I said that we're going to build stamina and you're going to read for 20 minutes. And oftentimes I'm conferencing with some kids about, you know, about the reading as the others are reading. But the other day, the trumpet went off on the smart board, the trumpet sound, and I had one student, you know, who wasn't really gung-ho about this whole idea of reading, say, oh, can we just have five more minutes? Can we just have five more minutes? So just really, that's music to my ears. So, and I'll hand it off to Laura, who'll talk to you about the writing.
So I feel like I'm a little bit more results. You know, everyone's talking about metaphors and beautiful things. I'd like to talk a little bit about what I see as the results of this. Mm-hmm. And you know, the standards are different now, and the standards are much higher, and our testing demands a much more higher level of rigor than before in our reading and writing. And so I feel that the writing workshop in middle school rises to that level of rigor and the rigor of the standards as well. And so, you know, for just an example of this, you know, to prepare for the long composition in the MCAS, we used to do an assignment, I would say. It was five paragraphs long, and we'd go through the writing process, and the kids would do fine on the MCAS with it. Now, you know, on the state test, they have to write a narrative, they have to write an argument, they have to write a literary analysis. So with the writing workshop, for instance, a literary analysis, what used to be, maybe we'd write a page, okay, and you know, then we'd revise it and we'd go through the process. Now, with the writing workshop, kids write almost like perhaps 20 pages of a literary analysis before they go to publish a piece. And so before the park, we wrote, most of us in the middle school now are writing our literary essays on the Great Books Roundtable, which is a very rigorous rigorous short stories. And so the kids after the park said to me, Mrs. Warren, you over-prepared us for the park test. And so I was like, I over-prepared, you know, I'm always like hurt, you know, and I'm like, I didn't do test preparation. I may have done 3 days of test preparation, you know, in terms of orienting them to the test. And what it was is they went into that test because the great books, they'd been so used to reading rigorous work and then had been so used to writing, you know, this volumes, and that they found it very, I guess, you know, doable, let's say. I don't know if it was easy for them, but it was doable. So, and I do, you know, I have to say, I mean, the results, you know, I was in Coolidge in eighth grade last year, and the results were great from this method, I think. And we had, We had 84% of our kids at level 4 and 5. We had 39% of them at a level 5, which was right up there with Belmont, Westford, and, you know, high-performing districts. 68% of them grew, okay, as well as 60% of the high-needs kids grew. So I feel like it's a method that works. I know testing isn't everything, but it's important to our district. So I also think it gives kids, the students, the tools to write across the curriculum. I do have, right here, we have our recycling argument essay, and the kids, we can pass it around. They take notes on a nonfiction piece, and then they learn how to phrase an argument, a counter argument, which is, you know, it's such a great skill in our democracy now, how to argue with evidence. You know, I wish everybody had it, right? So,
Civil discourse.
So I think, you know, we don't, it's not assignment based. We give them the tools. So they go to social studies, they can go to science. They have the tools to make these arguments and these counter arguments. And so it crosses the curriculum as well. So I also believe that we can, you know, we can hit through this writing workshop. We can teach everybody, and I mean everybody. So there's room for the most exemplary writers to shine. And we give these mini lessons, and the kids can take off with them, and then we conference with kids, and we can bring the struggling writers to a place where I think is good. And so last year, I have some examples here. Like, it's the writing that kids did, I found was just extraordinary. I don't think I'm this like fantastic writing teacher or anything. I mean, I do what I can, but I entered all these kids writing into the Scholastic Writing Contest, and, you know, that's an, you know, I got one national award winner. Let's see how many we had. 2 gold keys, 5 silver keys, 8 honorable mentions. It's extraordinary what they're producing. And because we give them the independence and they do it based on their interests. So I think it's a wonderful program, and it's very results driven as well. Here we have the recycling group essay. This was some journalism. Actually, Linda was there. The Holocaust survivor shared a story with the 8th graders. So some of the kids wrote up that news story. And then we did some investigative journalism. We have here the privates or public, the 8th grade struggle. This is something that is so pertinent to these kids, they get into it.
Wanted to add that 2 sixth graders from Parker won Boston Museum, Sports Museum essay contest this past spring. So it's, you know, it's working across the district.
So we'd like to, Don and I, we could go to the next one. Okay. So, you know, these great methods, people can't do it alone.
No.
And so we have to collaborate, and that's what we do in our PLC. And we work to align curriculum, we look at the student work, we talk about how we're going to improve, we look at our data, and so that, you know, everybody in Reading, in both middle schools, gets the same experience and the same curriculum, and it's aligned.
Something to be said of the benefits of the 2 middle schools working together. We are a district with 2 middle schools, and we want all the kids in Reading to have the same experiences as they head off, you know, to Reading High School. And so, as I said before, but in all my years, I've never seen it working so well, you know. Part of it that Laura and I are really good friends. But anyway, I'll go on that. But it's just wonderful. I mean, teachers even said, you know, sometimes you know people's names, but you don't really know faces. And now people are having conversations, we come into meetings, and there's just this camaraderie and collegiality that, you know, it's just wonderful. I almost get teary-eyed about it when it happens. But as Laura said, it's simple, you know, sharing lessons. I mean, people are in each other's rooms taking, you know, with the iPad, taking pictures of graphs that are up, and then conversations are starting. You know, there's a jumping off point with that. I just wanted to talk too about, we have right now we have the units of study we're working through, and another book called Do It Yourself Literacy. And it's semi book discussion, but more research based, more of a action, like a research but action plan, so that as we read the chapters, then we go through the book and see what in there, what tools in there that we could use in our classrooms, and we work on them and share them with each other. So it's a much more active type of text based discussion than just, you know, talking about the book. So, a lot of good stuff. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, yeah, show that little video.
We have one.
Like 2 minutes.
We just have a quick video to. I think this might.
I like writing because it can write about fiction stories. You can write about pretty much whatever you want. And I like that we have like a moment of time to get a big chunk of time to do what that maybe lesson is about. So
in writing, I like how we can use our imagination and make up our own stories in your life, or if you're like doing a story. I like writing this year because I changed so much, because I use strategies such as new lens, and that helps me my writing get more details and more show them how rather than all of my methods. What I like about writing is I get off a lot of time and
basically saying, like, we have to set the ceiling high for our students in order for them to reach those goals. So that's what we're trying to do. So Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was wonderful. For me, there was so much good in that, but the passion of the presenters and the teachers just shone through. You must be a joy to be a student in your classrooms because you're so excited about what you're doing that how could any student not respond to that? So thank you for the enthusiasm as well as the thorough presentation. I certainly want to invite the committee to ask any questions that they might have, but I also want to point out that we're 20 minutes past schedule at this point, so if we could find a balance between, I have a couple of questions, but maybe keeping them pointed and Mrs. Webb.
I just have a quick question about homework. I think that I would think that if my my sons had Laura, they would be maybe if they were writing at home now, coming home with a writing assignment, maybe he wouldn't have sat at his desk for 2 hours. Nothing on the paper. So I'm just sort of wondering, you know, how that fits in and how you guys are leveraging, you know, what kids can also do at home to keep that excitement and maybe build on, you know, build some specific skills. I don't know, whether, or maybe they're not writing at home because you're doing such a good job in school now.
They are, I mean, and we give them time to write, like, we'll say 30 minutes, you write for 30 minutes, and so they do write. I just think, but most of it is, you know, it is in class, but there are times when you give them like 30 minutes of writing time at home and they will do it. So and they do it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They do. Sometimes it's, I try to sort of base my assignments at home, like on revision and editing, that time working with the piece away from it. They wrote it in class and now they've had time away from it, so it's not as great as it first looked. And so then they're revising it and working on it, sometimes then typing it, putting it into Google Docs, and so, and then coming back and working on it, and then we can use it, you know, the student working can become mentor text as well, you know, so.
Thank you.
But they would not have an assignment that would be 2 hours of writing at home. So.
Dr. Boxer?
I have just two feedback things and then a question. So I've worked with kids from Coolidge. I had feedback from Anna Ornstein, who was this Holocaust survivor, she is a practicing child psychiatrist and write papers, and she's was so impressed with the confidence and the excitement and the prowess of the students that came up to interview her. And how riveted the students were. And then I've also had experience working with some Parker students, and I actually read a story that I had written to them, and their ability to be tactful and constructive in their feedback, because I was truly asking them to help me improve my writing, they were just wonderful. And on point, they were honest, and I think that you can't pretend that comes from somewhere. So thank you. The question that I have is about the really early years. And I loved that you have the priority of loving reading, that they want to pick up the book, that they value the writing process, value the writing process of the product. Real reasons for them to write. I won't reiterate everything you said that hit me right here and right here. My question is that in the kindergarten to second grade year, there's a really big range. You know, kids are maturing physically, emotionally, socially, as well as academically and cognitively. And I know I've seen things online that say videos of this is where your child ought to be, and they need to write sentences at the end of kindergarten, and they need to do this. And so there's a hard balance. I'm wondering how you grapple with the balance of that big range and parents that think, and how do you balance the expectations and that maturational period for students, and stress and anxiety?
It's a challenge. I think we're working in the right direction. This year we started with storytelling, a month of storytelling, and then moving into just learning how to draw, how to tell a story with pictures, instead of just stick figures, but how to have your characters move and add labels, and then moving on from there to then start with the labels, that letter sound match, so it's a real great reinforcement for the foundations lessons that the teachers are teaching. So it's really great practice for the alphabetic principal and for them trying to get their message on paper. And so then as they move through that, then they'll start getting into the sentences. But it really goes really slowly from sounds to words to then strings of words. And the beauty of it is that if somebody walks into kindergarten, sometimes they do walk in and they're reading, that workshop model allows for them to write. If they can write more, they have that flexibility. So it really does allow for that differentiation. But right now they're still, I think they're just starting to label pictures in the kindergarten classes right now. So I hope that answers your question.
It does. And then the other piece of the question was like at the end of kindergarten in terms of deciding where they're at and communicating that that's okay or they need supports or
right. And so part of it is that the children throughout the year are being conferenced with by the teacher. So there's a close eye on where they are. And we also take pre and post assessments of where the kids start and where they're ending. So we have a clear picture of where they need to go. We're working on sort of calibrating our expectations as a district actually tomorrow. That's a beginning stage, but that's part of the process that we need to go through. But the kindergartners are quite amazing at how much growth that they can make given this sort of structure or this time to write. And those two samples that I showed you, the how-to they both were how-to. Those were your typical samples. I mean, one of them might have been, he was a reluctant writer in the beginning of the year. Once we took the drawing piece just to black and white, he just took off and started writing up the storm. And get to that. It's from his class. So I don't think what I'm trying to say is that it's for most of the kids they will hit that benchmark by the end of the year, given the time to write.
Thank you
so much. I had a question. So you've been in this position for a couple of years, and I wonder from the perspective of where you are now in the last couple of years, in terms of literacy, elementary and middle school, what's the area that you've seen the greatest growth in as a district, the greatest improvement, the greatest movement forward? And is there any area, conversely, that you're thinking, boy, we really need to address this in the next couple of years, the biggest area for improvement, if you will?
This is my second year. I did a lot of work last year with K-2. We focused on K-2. But I'm sort of have little projects with all grades, trying to get teacher leaders, like we had here tonight, to then also have teachers into their classroom, which is happening. So that's a way that we can cover more ground with just one person in this role. So we did a lot of work. We did a study group. We had Plymouth Public Schools, like I said, come up. We had that study group book club on talking, drawing, writing, and just really changed the pacing of the first 4 months of kindergarten. And so that was one area where we sort of, together as teachers, figured something out that wasn't really working, and hopefully we'll continue to tweak it, make it better. An area that we want to move into, I guess, is we're doing some work in the spring. We're having that DIY literacy book club where the author is actually going to be able to come and do some PD with us. I think that's an exciting thing where teachers said in the spring they want to read this book, and then we were able to get the author to Skype in, and she's actually going to come and do an in-service with us. So that's exciting. So there's definitely work to be done, but I think we're moving in the right direction.
Me too. And thank you very, very much. It was a phenomenal presentation and very inspiring.
Thank you.
All right. There was a topic that I said I was going to move to the front, and I was so excited to hear about the literacy curriculum that I forgot to, so I will do it now. It's towards the end of the agenda. I want to talk briefly about the school committee vacancy. At our last meeting, Julie Joyce announced that she'd be resigning from the committee. And I said that I would look into the past procedure and make sure that that is the correct procedure to move forward. So I did work with town council to get a ruling on how we fill this vacancy, and the way we've always done it is absolutely correct. So with the school committee's permission, I would like tomorrow to email the chair of the Board of Selectmen and request that the Board of Selectmen post the vacancy by our school committee, what do I want to say, not bylaws.
Policy.
Policy. I was just at a town meeting, that's why I'm thinking bylaws. School committee policy, but also state law. The vacancy is filled by a combination of the school committee and Board of Selectmen together. So that's an announcement for this committee, if anyone has any, but also for the broader public, because I think that there's some interest in that. So with, unless there's any concerns or questions from my fellow committee members, I'll send that email tomorrow. My anticipation is that the town clerk will very quickly post the vacancy. It will be available for a short period of time.
I believe it's a minimum of 2 weeks.
Oh, okay. It's a short period of time.
Yep.
So anyone in the public who's interested should quickly get in touch with the town clerk and find out when the deadline is. Anyone in the public, Reading resident, can certainly submit an application. And the Board of Selectmen and School Committee will meet jointly, and each has a vote. So the members of the Selectmen and the School Committee each have a vote. That person will only serve in the role until April, at which point it will be filled by an election. And something I did not realize, but the criticalness, particularly with budget season upon us, of filling the vacancy is, even though we are down to 5 members, it still requires a vote of 4 for motion to carry. So, you know, all we need is one person to be absent for illness or another reason, and we're kind of struggling to get things through. So it really is very important that we post that. So unless anyone has concerns, I'll send an email tomorrow.
Yeah, I just wanted to clarify. So it's two members of the committee, school committee, 2 members of the Board of Selectmen that make the decision, or is it the full
complement? So they have 5 members, and we currently have 5
10
members.
Votes.
So it will be 10 votes.
Okay.
And that's actually state law. I didn't realize that. That's not local. That's state.
I don't remember that it was done that way in the past.
It's
but
the same
it,
way we've
it
done
is,
it the
okay.
last.
So, and
yeah.
I guess that's a public
yes.
just that's a public process.
Oh. Completely public, and actually members of the public should be aware of that too. When you
right.
apply, you are interviewed, it is on camera,
public.
It is filmed, it is fully public. And our discussion and votes are all public.
Right.
This all happens.
That's what I wanted to
I'm
clarify.
I'm really glad you clarified that. And yes, Dr.
Can
Dr.
I just clarify that when the election happens in April, it's for the remainder of the term, so it's 2
mm-hmm.
more years?
Mm-hmm.
Correct.
Exactly correct. And the reason
thank
for
you.
That is to keep the school committee will always
cycles.
Have 2 seats up every 3 years for continuity.
And the other thing is the person that applies doesn't necessarily have to run in April.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Or run for that spot.
Right.
Absolutely. Any other questions?
No, I could just reiterate what you had said. The format, I did it a couple years ago, and you were actually up there asking questions, so it was 5 and 5.
Okay.
Yeah. I went through a similar process myself. Okay, thank you so much for being here tonight. We are going to, actually, yeah, 2 members need a quick recess, so we will take a 5-minute recess and resume.
It was in the senior center there. Everybody's chatty.
Everyone is chatting. Thank you, everybody. I'd like to resume our meeting, November 7, 2016 meeting, to call it back to order. Thank you to everyone for the courtesy break. We are going up to next on our agenda. We're going to discuss ballot question 2, which is a ballot question statewide on the ballot tomorrow, relative to charter schools and whether or not to raise the cap in the state of Massachusetts. So I think some committee members have prepared and are ready to discuss this. Anyone kick us off? Yeah, this is up.
I'll start. So I, in terms of charter schools, my personal history in terms of supporting the public schools in my role as a school committee actually started with Superintendent Scatini some years ago when a district a little bit north of us in Gloucester was struggling with a charter school being forced upon them that they did not want. And at that time, I know that, you know, some aspects of the charter school have probably changed a little bit since then. I don't really remember what year that is, but maybe that was 07 or 08. And I know we went to many state school committee, state Board of Education meetings, actually, went to MASC meetings, went to Gloucester. And in the end, that school was forced on them. And that charter was revoked because the school eventually failed. And if you look at what's going on in Gloucester now in their public schools, and their district is extremely demanding, there's a very high percentage of free and reduced lunch, but they have in their high school a statewide recognized science teacher, they have statewide recognized robotics and science programs, their O'Malley School is an innovation middle school. And I think what it points to for me is putting the resources in the public schools and doing what we need to do in our public schools. And I truly do believe, I've looked at the data, people can look at it different ways, we've all seen the TV ads, but I believe that that money gets inappropriately siphoned out of our districts, the public districts, and put into the public charter. I have been against the question from the start, and I appreciate the Reading Teachers Association. And I think that there's multiple aspects of this, but one, we could look beyond ourselves. So I just talked about Gloucester. We could talk about other districts. And Jim Roscoe was here a few weeks ago. He's a parent in Reading. He is the phenomenal leader of our youth wrestling program. And he's a teacher in Somerville. And he talked about his personal experience in the classroom. And I've talked to other teachers, but I mean, that was very compelling personal experience. But I also would like to read from an article that was recently in our local papers. And so I'm going to quote this particular article. There are so many reasons to defeat question two, but perhaps the most powerful one speaks to our situation here in Reading. Our FY18 budget is not level funded, and after 3 years of cuts, our town did not approve the override, which would have provided essential funds to prevent school and town cuts. Despite many improvements across the district, this year's test scores have maintained a level 3 status for one of our schools, which means that our district is level 3 status. We are a petri dish for an aspiring charter school business. This is big business. If we let them, they will come, and funds will be siphoned out of an already insufficient budget for the students of Reading. And I quote that from Mrs. Doctor, who's sitting next to me. That was her article.
Written as a citizen,
but I again, so I support all of you and our district, and appreciate you guys all being here tonight.
Dr. Doxey.
I wanted to just reiterate that this isn't about whether some charter schools do good for students. It's about lifting the cap and the amount of money that will be siphoned off from our public schools and the lack of oversight that these public monies then get in the charter schools. There's been a lot of talk about waiting lists, 33,000, but there's also been some clarity on that invalidity, is that the right word, English teachers? Invalidity of those numbers, because the charter schools are allowed to roll over those numbers. So if those on the waiting list have found sites, have found places in other schools, or no longer want to, they're still on those lists. So we have to be really careful about how the data can be massaged. That is not to imply that there is malintent. However, charter schools are businesses. And they are not necessarily permanent businesses, as has been experienced in other states. So often they siphon the money out, they siphon the students out, the public schools struggle, and then the charter schools leave. And the public schools no longer have the resources, the space, the whatever they need in order to service the students that come back. Similarly, often the children are disciplined and expelled, and they need a place to come, and the public schools are a place. And this is from a discussion at the Mass Association of School Committees last year, where they actually had a vote to send a message to the state that it wasn't okay for charter schools to send their children, send students back right before testing, so the test scores didn't reflect on charter schools' records, but rather it reflected on the public schools that were mandated to receive them. Public schools are very willing and open to accept any child, but they bring with them the negative reflection of the education that they didn't receive in that public school. Sure. And so there were a lot of schools from challenged districts, and I know there's been talk about Reading being egocentric, and we don't yet have any charter schools that are siphoning off, well, we do have some, but we don't have a remarkable amount of funding siphoned off. However, these are schools from more impoverished or less affluent communities that are also saying that they get the kids back and they have to service them, but they don't necessarily get the fundings back because the mechanisms aren't there yet. So I have been against raising the cap. There are many mayors and leaders in the Boston public schools that are against raising the cap. There's a lot of money trying to educate people to raise the cap, but I think that I'm thrilled to see the teachers who have turned out. Thank you. I know it's late, and I know you have to go to our kids in the morning, but that's a real statement.
No, right? You have a day off.
No, they're
in service.
They're in service.
I'm sorry. I knew that too. Anyways, but vote first and vote no. That's my opinion. Sorry?
No, she doesn't have that thought.
I'm not what, allowed to say that? Oh, I'm not allowed to say that. So my opinion is that I hope this will not pass for the sake of our public schools. Oops.
Yes. Mr. Robinson.
Yeah, I would support a no vote as, you know, to that point. But, you know, I'm doing that because my feeling is our assets walk out the door every night, and that's our teachers. And if this is something you're passionate about, then I support you for that. However, I as a school committee member, you know, when I was elected, my responsibility is to make sure we have a budget that's sustainable for the district, that we pass good policies and set good policies. We make sure that our district office leadership is doing well. I think that as this school committee member, I don't feel that I have a lot more responsibility to this district, and I don't feel that we should be putting so much energy into these statewide questions. But again, I support you know, what the teachers want, as I said, because you know, you are the district. So.
Okay. Anything, Mr. Mann?
Sure. I'll try to be brief. It's going to be hard. I think, you know, as Dr. Doxer stated, you know, there's really a good need in some situations for charter schools, and this isn't about whether or not I support charter schools or not. It's just the cap. And biggest concern that I have is the funding mechanism. I can tell you, I work as a consultant and talk to superintendents all over Eastern Massachusetts, and they're not getting reimbursed to the extent that they're supposed to get reimbursed. One local district very close to us sends students to Mystic Valley Charter School, and they get 16 cents on the dollar returned by the state. And that's not the agreement that was laid out initially. It was, you know, depending on the year you leave, you're supposed to get 100%, and then subsequently 5 years after, 25%, which is ridiculous anyways, you only get 25%. But that's my major concern. But some other things that I've thought about too is, you know, we have 99 charter schools in the state of Massachusetts. There's still 21 available. Now, I know there's some discrepancy as to, well, some cities may be maxed out, but to me, that seems like that's easy to work out. If Governor Baker can call me today on the phone, call me by my first name, I didn't pick up. I just listened to his voicemail. Although I regretted that I didn't pick up because I would have had it, but I'm sure it was recorded. But he did call me by my first name, though. I don't know how they did that. That said, you know, I think that it's quite feasible for them to figure out a way to distribute those other 21 that are still available. Plus, this Horace Mann Charter Schools, I'm not sure if everybody's familiar with Horace Mann Charter Schools, very beneficial. I've worked with a school district in Amesbury that has a Horace Mann Charter School, and it's worked well for their community, and it's got the opportunity to do very similar things to what the Commonwealth Charter Schools have to do. And I think the big difference is the Commonwealth Charter Schools are primarily driven by big businesses, hedge fund managers that want to make money off of our kids and take our money and put it in their pockets. Again, there's still a need for these charter schools. I have a close friend that works in a charter school in a city that was in receivership. And you know, if you're in receivership, then you definitely need some help from the outside. So there's a place for it. The other thing that stuck in my mind too was when I was reading, and I did a lot of work on this, working in some graduate program, getting a doctorate in education. And one of the things that I read that really stuck out to me was that those states that don't have caps have seen lots of problems, schools opening and closing within a month. The administrators are corrupt, and you know, because you can't tell me that DESE has the ability to oversee additional charter schools to the extent that they may possibly have, because they cannot do it now. They've been trying to get Mystic Valley Charter School to send them their fiduciary requirements, and they won't do it. And they've had issues relative to, and there are regulations about the charter schools. One of them is the board of directors has to have term limits. Well, they've had the same 12 people on mm-hmm. since the beginning. So if they can't get them to follow what's currently in place, how could we possibly expect them to, you know, continue to actually be able to, you know, to oversee additional charter schools? So I'll leave it at that.
Mm-hmm. Is there anyone from the public who wanted to speak to this issue tonight? Yes.
Should I move this up?
Yeah, and if you just state your name.
Erin Calvobacci. I'm actually just re-asking the question that I had asked 2 weeks ago, so that the public, actually a few people had reached out to me and they were kind enough to answer, but I just want to ask again for the benefit of the public. I had asked what differentiates the money that leaves our district going to charter schools versus the money that leaves the district for the vocational schools.
It was very nice of you to come back 2 weeks later to ask the same question. I remember you asked, and I said at the time it wasn't on the agenda and we couldn't engage in that discussion. So, Dr.
I'll be glad to answer. Sure, I can answer some of it.
And you can jump in.
The funding.
Go ahead.
Oh, sorry.
Go ahead, Dr. Dorton.
I'm sorry. I didn't realize it.
The number one difference is that we have control over that. I've been a town meeting member for 25 years. They have to put forth their budget to us every year. And it has been turned back to them saying, well, that doesn't add up. We don't have that many students, so we're not going to pay that much. The other thing is that serves a need that we can't provide anymore. We used to have a comprehensive high school way back when. The state of Massachusetts really doesn't do that. I do think the vocational schools do make out in this deal, because I do officiate high school sports, and I'm always impressed with the facilities that these vocational schools have. And the other thing of it is, we vote, if you haven't voted yet, you would have noted that you had an opportunity to vote for the representative to that board from Reading. So we do have some say in it. It's a good question, and I've heard it asked before, but it, you know, that's my perception on it.
I was going to say, the funding mechanism, the money from, if a student leaves the district from the public schools and goes to a charter school, it comes out of your Chapter 70 funding formula. whereas with vocational schools, that's a separate budget that actually is voted on at town meeting. It is not part of the school department budget. So when someone goes to Northeast Voc, which is our home vocational school, a certain amount of money is assessed to the town based on the number of students that leave and go to the vocational school.
So if this, if the question passed, we would not at town meeting have that opportunity to vote on the money? Is that what you're saying? The same way we
No, vocational school funding is a totally different mechanism.
But for charter schools?
No, you no, we town meeting does have. Not have.
We would not.
No.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Oh, yeah.
Can I just clarify? So not only does the town not, but this committee, the people that you elected to help set policies and manage the district and don't have any say in anything that goes on in that charter school either. And the amount of money, you have to look at it, the amount of money per pupil that transfers to the charter school is not the amount of money that it would be commensurate with educating that type of student, because a public school has to educate all of the students across the spectrum. You might imagine that our number, the average number, would be higher. As other people have alluded to, the charter schools don't service some of the students with the most significant needs. And yet that money that transfers over would sort of reflect that on average, and that's not the students who go. And as Mr. Roscoe pointed out, and others, Ms. Stocks are referred to with the Boston perspective, students often, if those students do leave, they often come back to the public schools. So that's another perspective on the funding drain or siphon.
I just wanted to also add that, first of all, I'm sorry for my little slip there. but nor do... nor do our expenses go down. When the students leave, there are fixed expenses in our schools. So it's not like the buildings or the insurance or the transportation or whatever. Those fixed costs, those don't go down because a student is leaving. They leave, their money leaves, and we still have those expenses.
In other words, if I could add to that too, that was a great point that you made, Dr. Doxa, and I appreciated that as well. Your letter was excellent.
As a citizen.
the fact that, let's say you have a class of 25 students and one goes to a charter school, you don't deduct the teacher's salary by 1/25th, you don't subtract the cleaning of the building by 1/25th, as Dr. Doxa pointed out, this fixed cost. And other states too, Mr. Lippitt pointed out today in his letter, that fund it from the state. You know, if they really are that sincere, if Governor Baker is that sincere and feels it's so important, then figure out a way to fund it from the state. Use the money that they're supposed to send us, which they don't. So it's got to be done equitably. Thank you for the initiative to talk to us too, from the RTA to the school committee.
Thank you very much. It doesn't look like there's anything else from the public. I do have a slightly different perspective than my committee members, although I respect their perspectives. You know, the last time the cap was lifted was 2010, and in that time, 75% of the growth has been in 8 districts. So I do view this as predominantly an urban issue. So I would leave it with that. I do think we're ready for a vote. I will abstain from this vote based on that I don't share the concern that fellow committee members have that this would be impactful to Reading. As Mr. Nyan said, there is room under the cap for expansion of charter schools that could happen in Reading with or without the cap. So, yes.
Move that the Reading School Committee opposes the passage of question 2, which would raise the cap on Massachusetts charter schools.
There's a second there. All those in favor. In favor is you oppose question 2. All those in favor? Opposed? It's 4-0, one abstention. That measure passes.
If I could make one comment.
Yeah.
I would like to think that the vote would infer that, even though we didn't read the resolution, but that our vote does, in fact, infer that we do agree with that resolution, and therefore you can add our names to the 200 other school committees.
Absolutely, absolutely. We joined the list of school committees that opposed it. Absolutely, Mr. Nine. Good point. All right.
Thank you all for being here.
Yeah, thank you.
Really appreciate it. An excellent day tomorrow.
Thank you.
After we vote.
It's not a day off.
Playing golf?
We'll be learning tomorrow. We're learning. We're learning tomorrow.
Right, you're going to school.
You'll be in the pathway somewhere, I bet.
Because it's 9:20 right now, and you need to get your parents. You don't want to.
Thank you.
Yeah, my mom's texting back.
You got to do attendance goals.
Yep.
Personnel should take that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll probably get going too.
Yep. It's at the end. So, Dr. Doherty.
Boy, I know how to clear a room.
I'm interested in the district improvement plan and your goals. So, we're in a tricky spot. We're 35 minutes behind schedule, and we have some other relatively important items on the agenda. My hope and my expectation is the committee was able to at least review this before we got here. So, I don't want to give short shrift. It's a really important topic. But
I'll try to keep it.
Yeah, concise. Feel free to.
I actually think that the presentation you saw tonight from our teachers on literacy was a great segue to the district improvement plan and the goals that we're doing as a district, because what you saw in literacy is happening in the other areas as well. And what we've tried to do the last few years with our district improvement plan is build a structure and a framework that you're now starting to see come to fruition and seeing some great things happening in the classroom. We certainly are not there yet, and that's what this next phase of our district improvement plan is going to take us. So the other thing that I think you'd notice this year is that it's two different documents. The district improvement plan has a goal with four focus areas, and then separate from that is the superintendent's goals. It really should have always been done that way, and now we are splitting it, and really my goals are aligned to the district improvement plan, which, as you'll see in a minute, everyone in the district has that alignment, which keeps us all focused in the same areas. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about the process to remind the committee and the community how this works, talk about the improvement plan, the focus areas, the goals, and then take any questions. The process itself, for the last couple of years, we've used the department planning for success process, and you see that again in our action plans this evening. A lot of time and effort has gone into this with our administrative councils beginning last June when we reviewed the district improvement plan that we've been using for the last couple of years. We reviewed the goals. Remember, we had 5 goals last year. So we reviewed those, the action plans underneath all those, and how we can continue to improve and move forward. We spent the summer doing that. We fine-tuned the direction that we wanted to go in August at our second retreat in the summer, and then really put the final touches on it this fall. So the final product is what you're seeing tonight. This gives us a diagram of the main goal. The one goal is in the middle, addressing the academic, social, and behavioral health needs through our MTSS framework. Through that, you have four focus areas: closing the achievement gap, literacy, which you heard about tonight, mathematics practices, which I believe you're going to hear about in December, social emotional learning, which you're going to hear also about in December, and then the overarching focus area that's embedded throughout all this now is communication and how we're communicating out to the community, how we're communicating within the district about these different focus areas. So instead of communication being a separate goal like it was last year, it is embedded in the work that we're doing every single day. So here's our district goal. Not to read it, but I think you can see that really it focuses on a couple of key phrases here. Increasing student engagement, improving achievement, decreasing discipline referrals, enhancing parent and community two-way communication. Those are the big cornerstones. We're using the framework, the MTSS framework, of data, systems, and practices. And I think if you remember those circles that connected from some of the presentations that you saw last year about the framework, it's everything that we're doing through that framework is going to focus on the data piece, the systems, which are all the things we're going to put in place to support our staff, and then the practices of the interventions that we're going to be doing with our students. The four focus areas, as I already mentioned to you earlier, are listed there. They each have their own action plan, which you can see are labeled A, B, C, and D. And so how do we know we're going to get there? So over the next 3 years, these are the things that we're going to see if we're implementing our action plans the way we would like to. So you're going to see, and I'm not going to read all of these, but you're going to see, obviously, a decrease in the achievement gap on our local assessments and our state assessments between our high-needs subgroup and our general population of students. The accountability rating is going to become more favorable. Now, I do want to mention that the accountability system is going to change again. We don't know yet what it's going to look like. There is discussion now, and there's going to be focus group sessions throughout the state because of the new federal law change with ESSA, that the accountability system is going to change. And it is going to have additional data points that are going to be used as well as the ones that have been currently used. So I wrote it in this way because we don't know what the accountability system is going to look like in the future. But obviously we want it to be more favorable. Other things you're going to see, alignment of report card grades, local and state assessment scores. We want to make sure that what's reflected in our report cards is a reflection of what's going to be a predictor on our state assessments. And that's really of a consistency issue, an expectation issue. You heard tonight about the expectation in writing. Those are the types of level of expectation we want to make consistent in all the areas across our grade levels and both vertically and horizontally. We want to make sure students have equitable access to higher level classes, all students. We've talked about that in the past. And we want to make sure that all of our students have a greater opportunity to access high quality tier one instruction so that all students are getting that same type of instruction, that we're minimizing pullout, and it's more push in. You heard about the term push in tonight, and that's when the staff are going in and working with the students in the general classroom setting. Those are the types of things that we are striving towards, and we're gonna see as measures of progress. In terms of literacy, very similar. In terms of the state and local assessments, we're also going to be using some other local assessments like our Fountas and Pinnell benchmarks, which we use for guided reading levels, DIBLs, math and science assessments, et cetera. You can see there. You are going to see a presentation in November, the next school committee meeting, from Linda Williams about our SAT and AP scores and participation in college acceptances. So that's certainly data that we are watching closely. under mathematic practices, very similar in terms of the assessments that we're looking at. But we're also going to see some other things. As our practices are strengthening at the elementary level and into the middle school, and we're already starting to see this, we will see an increase of students that are going to be into grade 8 algebra, which subsequently will give them also, we'll see an increase, and we're already starting to see this increase because of the shift in the standards and the shift of our instructional practices, students staying in math in the higher level courses and getting to calculus. And those are certainly things that we're going to be focused on. And then finally, the social emotional. We have a lot of areas that we focus on. Some of this is grant driven because we're required to focus on some of these data points, but others are our own internal data points that we look at and we have been looking at on a regular basis, like the YRBS, which is something that we've been monitoring. This year is the year that the students will be taking the YRBS again. So obviously that data is very important to what we're doing with social emotional learning. So those are the four action plan areas that are under our one goal. And then embedded is the communication piece, which is this piece here.
One question. So I see this focus area D, John, if we just go back to that social emotional learning.
Yep.
But then on the first page with the mission, vision, theory of action questions, it actually says implement health and social emotional learning curriculum. And I just really want to make sure that it's in this packet.
It's in the actual action plan.
But we are not really working K to 8 on our health curriculum because it's a gap in our budget funding. So I just want to make sure.
We're doing what we can with the resources that we have. And this year we introduced health lessons, and I know it's not where we want to be. What we did is introduce health lessons in our elementary grades 3, 4, and 5.
But this is 3, 4, and 5. Okay, so the health, yep. The health that you speak to there is sort of these lessons that we implemented in 3, 4, and 5. Does that say that explicitly?
Which is
here? I'm looking at just the short bullet items that are on the front page of the focus areas for,
yep,
district goal, right? So I just want to make sure that people, that we are clear about what we're talking about, in terms of what we are going to be able to support with funding in terms of actions toward the goal. So
yeah, it's clear that there will be some areas because that we did not get the additional funding because of the override that are going to be affected by this.
Okay, so the health piece referred to there is sort of the 3, 4, 5
The health
lessons
of the middle school is a big piece that will not get,
okay,
done at this point.
Right, I just wanted to clarify.
I guess just an initial observation, and I got to think about it more, but I look at the different, you got literacy, mathematics, and then social emotional learning. We only have one action for literacy, two for mathematics, and 7 for, is that, seems to me like we're putting more emphasis on that than math and literacy, or am I just...
No, there's a progress. If,
yeah,
you look at the action plans,
mm-hmm,
there's,
yeah,
a lot more detail in what we're doing.
Okay.
But the data that we're collecting, I'll go back to literacy. There's a lot of data in that bullet.
Okay.
I could have broken it down, to many bullets, but there's a lot of data in that bullet.
Okay, just as I said, an initial.
And the same with math.
Okay.
Each of these four focus areas are very important and are based on the data that we have right now.
Yeah.
So
So just because there's sort of more detail, line item detail on the social emotion, it's not saying that that's more prominent than the literacy or the math or closing the achievement gap.
It's that these data points are a little bit more specific because of the nature of the data point.
Right, how they're collected, or
they're not tests.
Right.
Okay.
So that's the district improvement plan piece.
Thank you.
You want to move on to the goal piece?
Yeah.
Okay. So as every educator goes through this process in the district, I also have two goals. The way it works in our district is we have our district improvement plan, which this year is one goal, five action plans. My educator plan is linked to this plan. You have your school improvement plans that are aligned to our district improvement plan. We have nine, the eight schools plus RISE preschool. All principals' educated plans are aligned to their school improvement plans. And then you have individual teachers' educator plans, which are aligned to school improvement plans or the district improvement plans. Each teacher has a student learning goal and a professional practice goal. So the way that the five-step cycle works, again, this is for all educators, so this is kind of like a refresher. And so the first piece is a self-assessment. So what I did in here is I did give you a self-assessment. I went through the rubric, identified the areas which I feel are areas that are strengths, and then there are areas that I feel I need to strengthen, which is a whole part of the process. I also looked at other data that, as you can see, aligns to some of the things I talked about in the district improvement plan. So that's the self-assessment piece. The second step is the goal setting piece, which is what I'm sharing with you this evening. So what I'm sharing with you is what's called the educator plan. And that's the second piece of the document. It's the second document you receive, which are my two goals. The implementation would be the next step. So once the goals are approved by the school committee, we begin the implementation. We've actually already started implementing a lot of the things that we've been talking about. The fourth step is there a mid-cycle review. So sometime in the January-February time frame, I will be reporting back to you the progress that I've been making on the goals and the district improvement plan, giving you evidence on where we're at, updating the action plans that you see here tonight. And then the fifth step is the summative evaluation, which is done at the end of the cycle. So that's kind of a refresher of how the process works. So my student learning goal is really closing the opportunity gap, which looks very familiar to you because it's the district improvement plan piece. So you can see there that really it is my leadership of working with other leaders in the district and teachers in the district to implement our four action plan areas. And then my second goal is communication, that my focus, and I think I've already started, as I explained to you, some of the things we're already doing, is communication. So my goal is a separate second goal on communication above and beyond what we're doing as a district with communication.
So above and beyond the communication linkages.
Correct.
Amongst the
correct.
Four. Okay.
And then in the document here are the steps that I'm taking for my goals. Again, this is a process that all educators in our district use. It's just that mine's public. So I don't know if you have any questions. I think that's it.
Yeah. Not at this time.
So Dr. Doherty, I had a question.
Mrs. Webb, you kind of touched on it earlier. Do you think, given budget constraints, that these goals are reasonable?
I think most of it is doable. There are some specific things like health at the middle school that obviously we're not going to be able to do right now. I feel it's important to leave those in there. because at some point, I believe that we will have the funding to be able to do some of these things. But as I mentioned earlier, a lot of the things we've been trying to do for the last couple of years is build a framework and set of systems that existing resources should help us with. So I think for the most part, we should be able to do the bulk of what we see here.
And you anticipated my next question. Is it right at this point to reevaluate the goals based on budget constraints? And what I'm hearing from you is that the handful of areas where maybe we can't do it, you'd like to leave them in, because they do leave a trail of what the ambition is.
Yeah. And this is a three-year process that we're looking at here, so.
Good point. Mrs. Webb.
I guess I hear what you're saying. I appreciate that. But I also feel like there's some, you know, goals, even when you look at communication, you look at so many of the things that we're trying to do around professional development, you know, building learning communities, teachers to work with each other across grade levels, across schools. And I think the thing that we can't really predict right now is, you know, that we know, because we've been through this before, the impact of reductions in force. And as we go through this budget, you know, you can't, that it's there, it takes so much time to build up these processes and get the commitment and get people working together. And I think we just have to be cognizant that it doesn't take that much when you're in those kinds of conditions. It's the same thing in private industry, right? When there's a reduction in force, it impacts the whole. And so, I mean, hopefully we can work through the budget process in the best way we can and minimize those impacts. But I feel like, I think then we have to keep our eyes on the fact that this is a three-year goal. And when we are, and I don't want this to be taken as I'm making an excuse, but I just want to be cognizant of the fact that when we hold someone accountable for performance and executing on a goal and achieving a result, then we need to give them, to the best extent possible, the resources necessary to do that. And I just truly feel like we are not able to do that. And so we will do our very best. And there's no other educators, Dr. Daugherty, his staff, the principals, I know will work incredibly hard at trying to minimize those impacts.
Yeah, but I think Ms. Borowski asked that question, and now is the time. If there isn't enough resources to do this, then we need to pare it back now and not come back with excuses that it was because of the budget. So I think, right, that was the question.
But then, it goes back to the statement, though, that was on the slide. It's interesting, the quote that she had on the slide in terms of setting the expectations, you know, high, so that there's an openness. So the struggle right now is, do we leave that expectation set, you know, at a level that is going to be, at this juncture, maybe too difficult for us to achieve, or do we pare that back?
So,
that was the question.
All right. Yeah, so I think here's a different way to answer it.
Yeah.
I can't answer the question right now, because we haven't gone through a budget process. We don't know what the reductions are going to look like. I do feel that these are the areas we have to focus on. I mean, our data shows it. I don't think we could say, oh, let's not do literacy this year. We can't do math this year. Let's not, you know. These are the, what I think are the critical areas that our district needs to address. So I think we have to wait and see how the budget process works out. If we have to go back and take a look at this differently, then we will.
Okay.
In April, yeah. Then.
Right. But I think it's important for the community to see that this is what we have to focus on. And it may mean that this is all we focus on,
mm-hmm.
You know, at every level.
That was well said. Thank you. Dr. Doxer.
I was also, when the discussion was going on about reasonable expectations for your goals, I agree that I don't think we can lower those expectations, because every one of our students deserves the opportunity to achieve it. And I think that it's admirable that you're aspiring to those high expectations. I think that we need to be cognizant of, as was in the last pathways, of data-driven versus data-informed decisions. And that when we're looking at the performances and the data as to whether or not the superintendent has reached his goals or made improvements towards his goal, that's where we have more data than just the results. I think that what's done, how it's received, what the impact is more than just the test results and other things. And I think that I don't think we should lower the expectations or the goals, but I think we have to take that into account in the evaluation. This is an instrument for learning and for improving performance. So to condemn someone because they didn't have the resources to achieve their goals when the effort and superlative strategies, et cetera, were there, I think that we need to take those into account at the mid-cycle review and as we go through the 3 years. I don't think that this happens in a vacuum, and I think that the high goals are important, but so is taking into account the resources that we've given to achieve those goals through the process.
Thank you. I have a couple quick and easy ones for you.
Sure.
On page 8 of your section, so it's under superintendent's goals, under literacy and mathematics, you list a whole mess of assessments, and I very much appreciate that we're going beyond the next generation MCAS, whatever it will be called.
Yeah, I don't
MCAS
even know what
2.0. But that we're going beyond state tests and looking at other measures, because the more we can look at, definitely the better. But my question was, under both literacy and mathematics, I think it's the exact same list of assessments.
Mm-hmm.
And that surprised me. I don't know if that was intentional or not. I was surprised to see, you know, benchmarks for guided reading under mathematics practice, or, you know, science assessments and math assessments under literacy. I didn't know if that was accidental or intentional.
It was intentional.
Okay.
Because I think you saw a little bit of this tonight in the literacy presentation. You're going to see the same thing in the math presentation, that a lot of the practices help other areas. In science, I mean, definitely in science and social studies, there are literacy connections. In science, you have math connections. Social studies, there are some math connections. And I think it's the practices that you can apply in different areas. So you're right, I could have taken them out, but I think because it's so integrated now, that's why I left them in.
Yep, that makes sense. Mr. Nyan.
Yeah, I just want to say that I'm impressed with the goals, Dr. Daugherty. I think they meet, as you said, the weaknesses that we currently have, and I think it's really commendable that you're willing to put forth those goals, and despite the fact that we may not have the funding to really make it work as well as we'd like to, but the fact of the matter is that we really have to do it regardless. And the only one thing that I would say is, and maybe it's touched in there a little bit, but one thing that concerns me, I know it concerned at least one other school committee member in the evaluation process of the superintendent, is teacher morale. So if there's something that I would like to see is some way that it's going to be, you've been through this before, I've been through this before, when we're faced with budget cuts and potential positions, teaching staff becomes quite unnerved, and I think whatever we can do to enhance teacher morale, we need to try to take advantage of if we want to be successful in terms of meeting our goals.
I'm hoping that that's a big part of my communication goal.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Good.
That those are the types of things that we do through effective communication with staff, feedback and visibility and things like that.
Yep, Mrs. Webb.
So I think I you know, I feel a little bit better. We say, and when we get to April and we see really where we are, we really should take another glance at these, because there's, you know, some really important goals about, say, students having access to tier one instruction, and there's a lot of goals and objectives that relate to all the aspects that Carolyn provides and is responsible for, and they, if we don't have the resources, we won't be able to achieve them. So I think we'll need to go back to that. And I actually just also, you know, closing the achievement gap, and I think that where we're talking about being focused and like what we saw today, we're talking very specifically about like how it happens in the classroom where it's most important, because that's for the students. But I don't actually have any expectation that we're gonna be coming off of level three anytime in the next 2 years, because I don't see that, you know, if we don't put the resources in, we can't do that. I'd like to see us strive for that, but I just don't wanna see, I don't see that I can sit here and hold, you know, the superintendent accountable to, we're gonna achieve that on the state assessment. What I wanna hold accountable is we look at what does that mean, closing the gap in the classroom and trying to make sure that we are giving the students the supports and they're making progress. So I think over the next couple of years, the student growth type data is really, I think, something that I might have to look at and weigh more heavily in my mind than the actual level, and you know, that would assume we don't necessarily, I don't anticipate that we would slide back, hopefully. I mean, we achieved level one with the high school this year, and you know, hopefully we can continue to keep that, but I don't see how, I guess I just don't want to say at the end of the year saying, well, we said we'd do this, we'd close the achievement gap and get out of level three. And I don't think that's what it's about for me.
And if I can, I was actually very happy to see that Dr. Doherty included this in his goals. And the only slight pushback I would say on that for me is I definitely am concerned that there are things we want to do that we won't be able to do, but the level three status in my mind isn't one of them. To me, that a lack of resources will not be an excuse for not getting out of that. And as evidence for it, I would point to the 30 districts that have a lower per pupil expenditure than Reading. Only four of them are level three, 26 are level two. So other districts are managing to pull themselves out with less resources.
But we haven't provided the resources over the last 3 years.
But neither have those 26 districts. Okay.
Then this is a big difference of opinion. I really want to, when I read that about what that means, that under AA, that means focusing on the students that need the support. And I would hope that there are measures for them of that maybe are not just the state and local assessments, but other measures that are a more comprehensive reflection of their growth and their achievement. And I am not going to be, I personally, for the next year, I am not gonna be as caught up on that. I want to be paying more attention to really the growth of those students, the more comprehensive view of what's going on. I definitely want to see, Joshua Eaton. I don't want to see our other elementary schools slide backwards. I do want to see Joshua Eaton improve. And I think the task force and the work that Eric Sprung has been doing and laid out there is excellent. But I'm a little tired of trying to hold our teachers, staff, our district accountable to achieving these unbelievable results without giving them the resources they need. So I want to focus on the kids, their achievement, make sure they're growing. Let's make sure that we're paying attention when Carolyn is saying, we have to devote more resources than at Joshua Eaton, or we need more tier two supports then if we're going to do this. Then we have to figure out a way to do that. It's going to mean we're going to have to cut somewhere else where it's going to also hurt. So I hope that you can all at the next year say, you know, you were wrong. I understand keeping the goals set high and the expectations set high. We may need to recalibrate in April. Perhaps in April, we'll have also a better sense of whether we've really been able to provide the resources that we need. And we'll have a better sense of whether we think, you know, we are going to lift that that school and that subgroup and this district out of that status. But I can't sit here right now and feel comfortable about that.
Yes, Mr. Knight.
So I appreciate your passion, Mrs. Webb. I hate doing that, Mrs. Webber. I just know you're as a lady, how old she is. Anyways, but I do think, though, you know, you hit on it. You said, you know, the allocation of resources is going to be important. And I do think this is really important. And Ms. Borowski, I was also very pleased to see that that was in there as a goal. And I give Dr. Daugherty credit for sticking his neck out and making it a goal. I think it's significant. And you know, I just think that it's something that needs to happen because it's a reflection on the entire district. If, you know, bad enough that it's a reflection on Joshua Eaton, but we are a District 3, and, you know, I think we're better than that, and I think it's capable. We're capable of, I brought a point last meeting where I asked if the principal at Melrose that moved from a 3 to a 1 had been on staff before, and he was, which led me to believe that, okay, so he really knows what's going on in the building, whereas last year Eric really had to kind of get a feel for it. He's probably still in that situation. So I think he's going to have that advantage now going forward, and I think it's more, you know, manageable and reasonable. I don't know all the details. I do know that we see the scores at, you know, grade 3, but, you know, it's just not grade 3. It's K-1 and 2, and it's something that, you know, he's getting paid pretty good salary to figure it all out, and he stepped into it, so he's agreed to do it. I'm confident that he'll get it done, and that's my sentiment on it.
I was wondering, Dr. Daugherty, if I could transition a little bit into social and emotional, and I only have two other questions, so I will wrap it up. On that same page 8, under social emotional learning, and these are really nuanced questions, they're not overly critical, but on B, it's a decrease in student anxiety by gender, race, general population, and I read that and I wondered, is that too broad of a thing for superintendent's goals? Because I am intimately familiar with the problem of anxiety and depression and mental health disorders and the increase of them in Reading statewide, nationwide, but that's such a cultural problem. And my question, I guess, is can a school system really be expected to move the needle on that? I think a school system can absolutely be part of the solution.
Yeah.
I'm a little bit nervous about saying that's your job to reduce the level of anxiety in our kids. It's a tall order.
So there's specific questions in the YRBS, as you know, that deal with depression, feeling sad or hopeless. Suicidality. Those are the areas that I'm referring to there.
Okay.
You know, there are some things that we're putting in place, and we have for the last couple of years with our social emotional learning curriculum, Open Circle, the mindfulness that we've been starting to do at the elementary, where there are some things now we're looking at the middle school to do. Those are things through the grant that are going to teach students how to cope with some of these things that are referring to in the YRBS. So I'm hopeful that we're hopefully going to start seeing a shift in some of these areas.
I suppose an argument for, when I was struggling with it, the argument that for it that came to mind was the fact that I believe the highest, or one of the highest, if not the highest stressor kids referred to was school work.
Yeah.
So that would suggest that the schools have a role to play in finding ways to balance their workloads better and manage stress. That was just a thought I had.
Nope, it's
just good point. One quick comment.
Mr.
Also, I think, you know, the social emotional learning, if we can see a decrease in what Dr. Daugherty had said, you know, those are anxiety, depression, those are all indicators of potential substance use.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So if you can lower those, you know, like you, I have familiarity with those issues too. And I think it's imperative that we work on it. You know, so I'm pleased to see it.
Yeah. Just to sort of highlight though, when you look at item D on that, right, an increase in students indicating they have an adult that they can connect with as evidenced by YRBS. So that's an area where I think it's so much more direct, and it's not, as you pointed out, for the other item, there's some cultural aspect there. Whereas this really relates to things that you've done and we've done over the years to assure that students have a teacher, someone in the school system that they, you know, feel that they, and we've seen really great progress
yep,
in that data.
Been an increase in that area.
And so I would think that with these goals and these five and the communication as a part of it, that we would see improvement. So that's an example of one that I think is much more direct.
Yeah, where the school can have a clear and obvious.
Yeah, impact. Whereas the one you pointed out, there's a lot of cultural factors. So I sort of agree with that.
Any other questions or comments from the committee? Dr. Doxson.
Mine is just, I think, a wording question. So in both the district and the superintendent's vision, the wording, so if you look on the first page under our vision.
Page 4, our vision, Dr.
Biden.
It must be the same, right?
Yeah, there's
a lot of, there is some redundancy on purpose.
Right, no, that's not my question. So my question is, in most other places you bring social emotional in along with the behavioral, but in the vision it just says overall physical and behavioral well-being. And I actually think that the social emotional is missing. It's under our vision. It says
yep.
our mission on the top.
Yep.
So if you look at
you're talking about this is the one pager.
Yeah. Yes.
The one pager. Right.
This is the elevator speech.
Yes. Right. But I think when you take social emotional out and you just leave behavioral, there's an assumption with behavioral that's
negative.
I know it's not the common definition of it, but behavioral is visible. And social emotional isn't necessarily, they're different.
Mm-hmm.
Although behavioral packages it nowadays.
Yep.
But I think that belongs in our vision.
Okay.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions on the goals? All right. Can I do a motion?
To accept the superintendent and district goals as presented.
Second.
Is there any further discussion, questions, comments?
No, thank you.
Can I just a technical question?
Sure.
So on the slide you showed the A under student learning goals, you showed closing the opportunity gap, and on this sheet it says closing the achievement gap.
Closing the opportunity gap was my goal.
Ah, okay, okay. Thank you.
All right, all those in favor? 5-0. Quarterly personnel update.
Yes.
This is something that I had heard was done on several other school committees. And I talked to Dr. Doherty about it, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe you said it was something that used to be done.
We used to do it.
And it
yes.
just fell out of practice. And so with the committee's indulgence, I'd like to give it a shot and see if there's value in it. I like the idea. What I liked about it was getting a regular update on positions as they transition, positions that are remaining vacant, just to, so this is a trial to see if it's something that the committee likes. So I'll turn it over to you, Dr. Doherty.
Thank you.
Thank you.
First, I want to give a lot of kudos and accolades to Jen Bovey, our interim HR administrator, because you can see there's a lot of positions here that she's been processing. The first quarter is always the busiest quarter for personnel. Most of this was summer hiring. So you can see it was an extremely busy summer. Actually less busy than last summer.
Wow.
When you look at it overall. For the most part, I broke down the reasons for leaving down on the last page. You see most of them are resignations, and resignations is a variety of reasons, which I've talked to the committee about before. There are some people that have left the state. You know, I have anecdotal stories of teachers that are teaching in other states. There's one teacher who left to go teach in an environmental camp in Colorado, which would be, that's a great opportunity. So you have those reasons. You have reasons that people are resigning because they're staying home with their family. You have people getting advancement to other positions. So there's a variety of reasons why people are resigning. We have retirements. You can see we had several retirements. This is all positions, by the way, not just teaching positions, just so you know. You have leave of absences, transfers, new positions, and then reduction of forces. So that's the breakdown. The majority is obviously resignations. So you could see that also we have a few vacant positions open. Most of them are paraeducator positions. But there are two teaching positions, I believe, still open. One is the position that we've talked about before, which is the special education teacher at the high school with a reading background. We continue to post that position and look for applicants. We do have contingency plans in place for services, and I think Mrs. Wilson actually talked about that at a previous meeting on how we're addressing those. But most of the positions that you see right now that are open are paraeducator positions. The custodian position actually was just filled. So that was just filled recently.
So I just recently heard that a math department teacher resigned. Is that? So
the person hasn't left yet.
I got you.
So they gave their notice. So that would be in your next report, you would see that position.
Clarify, so this is either FTE or hours, so I get that, except where it's like 60 hours, because I would have
that's a bi-weekly. 60 hours is bi-weekly, which would be 30 hours.
So, but anything under 40 is weekly, and then these 60s are?
Yeah, weekly is 35 or less.
Okay.
Benefit is 20 or
benefit
above.
Is a 20 hour a week or greater. Or 0.6 FTE when it comes to a teacher or greater.
On the resignation, are we capturing exit interview data at this point in terms of reason for resignation?
We are, yes. We give a survey.
Yeah.
Yeah. We don't sit down with every person that's leaving, but we do give an online survey that they answer.
That would be interesting information. I don't know if I need it quarterly, but at least annually to look at.
Mm-hmm.
That would be.
You did see that for last year.
Yeah. Which is what brought it to mind. I'd like to continue to see
did
that
data.
Did
we see the survey? I'd like to see the survey at some point.
We can see the survey.
What the
survey
is?
We saw what the data did revealed. But right. Yeah.
You did see the survey questions and the results.
We did.
Yes.
So you just said we don't sit. So wouldn't that person's immediate supervisor sit down with them?
No. No. It would be done usually at the HR level. We just don't have that capacity, so we give an online survey for them to answer.
But you would think that if a teacher's leaving, going somewhere else, they'd talk to their principal about it.
So. Oh, absolutely, yes, yes. But the official data collection piece, we do through survey.
Okay. Any other questions?
So there may be people, like I noticed at the very bottom here, so Jen Beaubay is a vacant. Her position that she left is vacant, but she's filling another position.
She's the interim HR administrator,
right.
so was in a paraeducator position.
Right, so she might be on here somewhere else, but I don't know, is that, would that be a lot? I didn't
There was a few
this.
Internal transfers.
Okay.
Not many. There was a handful.
I think it would be fairly easy to highlight duplicates. That would just help us see that we'd be able to see that there was an internal transfer. If she can do that, you know what I'm saying? So that we would see that.
Okay.
If it's easy, if not.
Okay.
Do you know what I'm saying? And maybe there's not that many of them.
It was only a few.
Okay.
And it was mostly para-educators.
Oh, para-educators, two other.
There may have been a teacher or two, but there weren't many.
Okay, that's fine.
Thanks for doing this, and thanks to Jennifer. It's just a different lens through which to see the district, so I appreciate it. Well, it's after 10, and we have one agenda item left, and I'm torn, but I'm looking at next week's agenda, and it's packed.
Yep, it is packed.
So my normal inclination would be, let's push this off till next week, but looking at next week's agenda, we're just going to create a problem, because next week we'll be pushing something else off. So what I'd like to do is have our final discussion, which was on the FY18 budget. And my hope is, you know, when I suggested this, it was to have a brief discussion, and just guiding principles means very high level, how we want to approach the FY18 budget, particularly in light of, we know we're looking at some cuts. So if anyone has any thoughts, I would just ask, and the name of the hour would be a bit succinct.
Yes. Just in terms of process,
sure.
So in order to keep it succinct, I think the way is if we each have our principles that we thought of, and we can just put them out there and state them, and then not necessarily, this is not the night to have dialogue about them, and frankly, they're really for Dr. Daugherty to hear.
Totally agree. And it's, this obviously, guiding principles is one thing, getting into the weeds in January with the budget is another.
Right,
so
right.
I agree, this is the beginning of a conversation, certainly not the end. So I think that's a good point. This is what sounds like you want to kick us
off. I do. I've been thinking about this since you said we were going to do this. So I have experienced this before as a budget parent, a parent and a budget parent, and as a school committee member. And one of the things that's really important to me after now having all four of my children completely through the district is while I think, you know, being fair and equitable on the impact is a good general guideline, I feel strongly that we need to really minimize the impacts to our juniors and seniors. This is their last opportunity to sort of complete their resume, to do their best to get into a class that they're trying to round their experience out, that they might not have been able to get into that class in past years. I think in past years when we've been in these positions, frankly, I think that the high school may have taken, high school students may have taken a bigger impact. In part because their parents don't show up in this room sometimes. And although we had a very vocal group of students last year. So I just want to make the case that I really think it's important to try to do our very best to keep the programs available for the juniors and seniors, to keep the sections available, and the courses, you know, it's they're looking for an AP class to finish. And it's, as we know, it's very competitive. I don't know what this year will bring for our seniors. Some of us had personal experience with it last year. It was extremely competitive. So that's one, my one guiding principle. We have two. So the other piece is really about wanting to, and I think the goals and objectives we just saw sort of keep that in line, but obviously to, you know, focus on our core programs, the literacy, writing, math, social studies, science, and the languages to the extent that we can. And if that means the class sizes are, then class sizes is our only place to push. If we're going to try to keep some programs, at least have some sections available to students, then it is going to mean the class sizes are going to get higher. I recognize that an increased class size can have a negative impact on sort of the quality of what the teacher is able to deliver. And when I think about that at the high school level, you know, I think about when you get 30 or 32 kids in a class, the teachers have to be maybe probably a little bit more choosy about what types of assignments they're giving, because they have to be able to grade that many. So I understand that, but I guess I would rather still have our students try to get some of those experiences. But clearly, we have to focus on, you know, those core areas. So that's my, those are my two.
Thank you.
So I'll just read mine. That'll keep it succinct. And so I'd like to see us work hard to retain the structures that will best promote the emotional, social, and behavioral health of each and every child so that they can learn and be inspired for this life journey. Learning does not stop here, as portrayed in our vision, goals, and questions. That's why the MTSS framework and collaborating PLCs are vital to promote the safe and healthy education of each child. To be specific about this, there are frameworks and positions within our schools that support our students, our teachers, and our administrators in this whole child quest, such as the middle school model, such as the PLCs and curriculum coaches, such as team chairs and collaborative work across the disciplines, grades, and schools. My second guideline was, in preparing our budget, we need to acknowledge that our responsibility is to all children with their diverse backgrounds, needs, interests, and strengths. This means that we need to maintain our programs in art, music, drama, and course choices that enable, so it's similar, that enable students to find their strengths, like language, robotics, and engineering, and we need to continue to make challenging courses available to those who want to pursue their passions.
Yeah, I can. I don't have a written statement. I think anything that's right in front of students, student facing, should be preserved ahead of other things. I don't want to see a budget that has any fees raised or offsets raised. I don't think we should use any gimmicks to balance the budget.
Unsustainable.
But we've been asking for fees over the, you know, over the
no,
last
I mean,
few
yeah.
years. So,
but
the main thing is, I guess, you know, preserve classroom teachers that are having the direct day-to-day with our students.
Mr. Nyan, did you want
to? Sure. Couple of things. I think, you know, I hate to say it, but I think everything's on the table. And that, you know, that it's, as Chuck has said, and I think everybody has said so far, is the decision should be student-centered. I'm not saying this is necessarily the case here, but over my career, I've seen budget crises like this. And sometimes I was always amazed at positions that may have been saved that were more about the adult stakeholders. I just think keeping it student-centered is so important. And, you know, discuss class size is one of them. And as Chuck said, keeping as many teachers as feasible. The one thing I would say about class size is that the research says that K through 3 is the most important grade level where we should keep class sizes low. And then, you know, I hate to use this term data-driven, but decisions should be data-driven, but I guess I'm looking at it a little bit differently in the sense that not necessarily, well, for example, what we saw tonight with the literacy program, we have to continue that. That's great progress. But if we're looking at, you know, adding anything, like, you know, it's hard to say we're going to add anything under these circumstances, but anything that's new that hasn't really shown that it's been effective, then that's something we should look at and decide whether or not we're going to keep it. And I just think anytime, you know, curriculum initiatives or approaches or instructional strategies, anything we should be using should have evidence behind it that it works, because the amount of money that we have is obviously mm-hmm. less than we expected yeah. and hoped for, so I wouldn't want to be experimenting with anything new.
Mm-hmm. You should never apologize for being data-driven, ever. I've written down a couple, but they're very consistent with what you're hearing across the board. Nobody mentioned state and federal mandates, and it's probably because it goes without saying, but we should say that so much of what we do is driven by mandate, mm-hmm. and we don't have the option of cutting that. So before you look at anything, you look at the mandates and say, well, this is what we have to do by law. The three remaining principles that I came up with involve academic achievement and doing everything we can preserve. There's been some good momentum across the district over the last couple of years in this area, and I really would like to see it continued. Equity, that we've passed a budget for the past several years that spends resources across the levels from preschool through 12th grade in a certain way, and I'd certainly like to see that percentages stay more or less the same so that there isn't one group of students being adversely affected and another group protected. So I'd like to see equity across the board in the budget, and several members brought it up, but sustainability. I think that given the outcome of the vote, we need to pass a budget that is sustainable. I think you said no gimmicks, a budget that is sustainable going forward. And so budget sustainability is on my list as well. Well, thank you all for doing that work. Mrs. Webb, you said that very well. It's the beginning of a discussion, the beginning of a long discussion.
A lot less time than I thought.
Yeah, well, people get very motivated at 10:10 at night to keep it succinct.
10:20.
Yeah. Well, when I said keep it succinct, it was 10:10, and look at that.
We
10
did
minutes.
Well.
We did very, very well.
Yeah.
Which I appreciate. I know it's late, and particularly to the staff, I know it was a late meeting. I appreciate your being here. Anything else before we adjourn? Dr. Doherty, anything for me?
No.
All right.
Motion to adjourn.
All those in favor?
Aye.
5-0. Four hands and an aye.
Eric.
Thank you.